Thank you very much for having me this evening. Superintendent Miller, is there anything you want to preface my presentation?
That'd be great. So you may remember that in January, we conducted a public opinion survey. We found research and communications to do that survey. He is very highly regarded in this type of work, public opinion work, and so we want to best. This is really, to my knowledge, the first time that Bexley City School District has engaged in this type of public opinion work. It's helpful for us as we have now started our strategic planning process. The information that we gathered is very helpful as we continue to move forward. And was very instrumental in helping us identify some of the themes that we have drafted for our strategic plan. So Paul is here tonight to give us some background and understand a little of the messaging behind the numbers. So Paulette.
Thank you very much. In the interest of time, I'm going to dispense with a formal introduction and just jump right into the survey results. Is this still plugged in? There we go. First and foremost, let me mention that the survey was conducted through telephone interviews performed by specially trained opinion research interviewers. That is, they weren't telemarketers who were trained to elicit affirmative responses. They were data gatherers who were trained to elicit truthful responses. The interviews were conducted with 300 randomly selected adult residents with district parent oversampling who resided in Bexley City School District. And we interviewed people using a combination of valid residential voice over internet protocol and cellular telephone listings. And the reason we called people on cell phones to interview them now is to avoid a coverage error that would be created if we just relied on, say, landline service, since a lot of households no longer have that. With 300 interviews, the estimated overall margin of sampling error is plus or minus 5.65% or 6% with rounding. It just means if we asked on a survey, for example, what is your favorite topping on a pizza? And 50% of the respondents said black olives. Because of sampling variability, that number could be as high as 56% to as low as 44%. The interviews were conducted during the period of January 8th through January 11th, so this is very recent data. And the data was stratified so that some differences in vital characteristics are represented proportion of their percentages of the population estimates for the adult population. Due to rounding, not all the results will add up to 100%. The data is presented in a slightly different order than the questions were asked. And lastly, let me point out that unless otherwise noted, only statistically significant differences will be presented here, although in some cases the absence of statistically significant differences is the story.
Can I interrupt you? I'm sorry.
Sure.
I'm never going to remember it, and I didn't see this verbiage on ours. So the sentence underneath January 8th, that the data is stratified, the difference in vital characteristics are represented. Can you explain that to me a little bit?
Sure. Just because we're using random sampling and probability samples, sometimes the some of the estimates will not comport with the actual results, and so we want to make sure that we weight the results so that groups aren't under or oversampled.
How do you know when they are?
We're using demographic data for the estimates, and then we take the survey results, and for example, if we interview too many men, we'll weight it downwards so they're not overrepresented. To avoid distorting the results because of oversampling. First and foremost, let's talk about the opinion environment. After some initial formalities, one of the initial questions on the survey was to ask respondents, what do you think should be the top priority for the Bexley City School District to work on over the next 2 years? And this was an open-ended question in which we took all the responses and consolidated them into categories. As you can see at the top, the first most frequently occurring response was special education at 10%. Another 10% of respondents said education quality. 7% said continue to do a good job. 7% said diversity and inclusion. On the third plateau, 4% said communication and transparency. 4% said to reduce taxes and spending. 3% said to focus on gifted students. 3% said expand extracurricular activities. 3% said more focus on technology. 2% said hire qualified teachers. Another 2% said improve the facilities. 2% said focus on average students. 1% said more focus on testing. Another 17% gave other responses, and 26% were unsure. As you can see from the call-out box on the right side of the slide, when we ran the results through a word frequency counter, some of the words that came up most frequently were education, which was used 41 times during the verbatim responses, student was used 30 times, special was used 27 times, program was used 18 times, teacher was used 18 times, quality was used 12 times, maintain was used 10 times, and improve was used 9 times. Here are a couple of the verbatim responses just to give you a little bit of a flavor for what people said. For example, when one respondent was asked, what do you think should be the top priority for the Bexley City School District to work on over the next 2 years? This respondent said, expand the special education program, and in general, make sure they keep improving academic performance. Another respondent said, I would say financial sustainability and educational achievement. Another respondent said, maintain the level of excellence that is present in our schools. I expect it to continue. Looking more closely at education, we asked respondents, overall, how would you rate the quality of education being provided by the Bexley City School District? And as you can see, a total of 95% rated it as excellent or good. Now, as you recall, just a moment ago, I mentioned that the overall estimated margin of sampling error is about 6% with rounding. So it's not unreasonable to hypothesize that it's a universal sentiment that quality of education is deemed excellent or good by everybody in the community. That's how exceedingly high the rating was for this community. By the way, as I said, I dispensed with a formal introduction at the start, but I did want to mention that I work in about 100 different school districts in Ohio. Probably have more clients as school districts than anyone else in my industry in the state. And I can tell you that's about as high as you ever see an education rating. As you can see from the inset box in the upper right-hand corner, the differences between parents at 95% and non-parents and 94% were not statistically significant. Just means there's an unacceptably high probability that that very modest difference was due to chance. Or more simply put, when you factor in sampling variability, you could not hypothesize there's a difference in the assessments for the quality of education, regardless of whether you're a district parent or not. By the way, a little bit of nomenclature. When I'm referring to parents, talking about people who had children enrolled in the Bexley City School District at the time the survey was taken. There may be other people in the survey who had parents who had children but were not of school age or were enrolled in charter schools. As you can see, among homeowners, 96% rated the quality of education as excellent or good, but that was not statistically significant when compared to the modest difference with renters at 94%. 95% of voters rated the quality of education as excellent or good, compared to 89% of non-voters. We also asked, do you think the quality of education is generally about the same throughout the schools within the Bexley City School District, or differs greatly from school to school? As you can see, 57% said the district's quality of education is generally the same throughout the schools. 24% said it differs greatly from school to school, and another 19% were unsure. Calling your attention to some of the results in the bar chart on the right-hand side of the screen, as you can see, reading the data in the horizontal bar chart, among parents, 51% said the quality of education is generally the same, 28% said it differs. Among non-parents, 64% said it was the same, and 19% said it differs. There's also an interesting statistically significant difference, and a substantial one too, between men and women. I'm not sure this is actionable, but I was intrigued by it. 66% of men, nearly two-thirds, said the quality was the same compared to just 50% of women. Also, among respondents in households with total annual incomes of less than $50,000 per year, 66% said it was the same, compared to 58% for respondents at the other end of the economic spectrum, that is people in households with total annual household incomes of $100,000 or more. Also, among 18 to 44-year-olds, 51% said it was the same, and on the other end of the age spectrum, among respondents 65 and older, 68%. said it was the same, so that was a substantial difference by age group as well. However, despite these differences, let me point out that these views do not seem to materially affect the assessments of the quality of education, because among those who said that the quality is the same, 97% rated the quality of education as excellent or good. And among those who say it differs, even 89% of them rated the quality of education as excellent or good. We also looked at some of the various performance ratings. For example, we asked, how would you rate the job the Bexley schools have done to ensure the social and emotional well-being of students? 65% rated the performance as excellent or good. We also asked, how would you rate the job the Bexley schools have done to provide students with life skills needed after graduation, such as seeking employment, managing personal finances, being able to live independently, and being a good citizen? 57% said excellent or good. And when we asked, how would you rate the job the Bexley schools have done to meet the needs of students from diverse cultures and backgrounds? 52% said excellent or good. And when we broke the data down and looked at race groups, and what we did was to have a large enough subsample of non-white respondents, we consolidated them into a single category, but even that difference was not statistically significant, with 47% of respondents of other races rating it as excellent or good. Looking just at parents, and that was a subsample of 151 respondents, 71% rated the job that the best Bexley schools have done to ensure the social and emotional well-being of students as excellent or good. When asked about the job that schools have done to provide students with life skills, 51% of parents rated the performance as excellent or good, and 48% of parents rated the job the district has done to meet the needs of students from diverse cultures and backgrounds as excellent or good. It was actually higher for respondents of other races, but again, that difference was not statistically significant. We also asked, thinking about the use of technology for teaching and learning, do you generally think that the Bexley schools use too much, about the right amount, or too little, or do you not have enough information to have an opinion about it? As you can see, overall, 5% said too much, 40% said the right amount, 6% said too little, and the winner was not informed at 47%, a plurality bordering on a near majority. Just 2% were unsure. As you can see from the inset box in the upper left-hand corner among parents, 8% said too much, 54%, a statistical majority, said the right amount, 10% said too little, 28% were not informed, and 1% were unsure. Looking at non-parents, 1% said too much, 26% said the right amount, 3% said too little, and 67% were not informed, and 3% were unsure. Looking at public finances, we asked, in your opinion, how would you rate the job that Bexley City School District does spending tax money and managing its budget? 72% said excellent or good. By the way, let me talk about this for just a second, because you probably have observed that there's a disparity between the performance rating for quality of education, which was 95%, and the performance rating for managing taxes and budget at 72%. First and foremost, let me point out that that's not unusual to have that disparity. God bless you. There are a number of reasons for that. And one of the biggest ones is that there typically are not a lot of telltale signs. For example, people know or can form opinions about the quality of education, even if they don't have kids in school, because they read about awards, college acceptance, graduation rates, and test scores. But unless something calamitous occurs or something problematic arises, typically there aren't a lot of telltale signs to formulate opinions about the job the school district is doing managing its tax dollars. And for that reason, people tend to be a little more conservative in giving their assessments. But nevertheless, that's an exceedingly high number. As I said, I have a number of other school districts in Ohio that I work with, and I tell them that ideally they want to be at or above the 50% threshold in this particular performance measure. You've not only met, but you've exceeded it by leaps and bounds. Looking at the inset box in the upper right-hand corner, among parents, 77% said excellent or good, but that was not statistically significant when compared with non-parents at 69%. Among homeowners, it was 75%, 66% among renters, 69% for the 18 to 44-year-old age cohort, 76% for the 45 to 64-year-old age cohort, and 74% for for respondents 65 and older, there were no statistically significant differences when comparing voters at 72% and non-voters at 80%. We also asked, generally speaking, would you say that property taxes in the particular area where you live are too high, mostly pretty fair, or too low? 57%, a majority, said pretty fair. 36% said too high, 1% said too low, and 6% were unsure. As you can see by looking at the horizontal bar chart on the right-hand side of the screen, once again, there were no differences between parents and non-parents at 33 and 37% respectively. There were no differences between men and women at 35 and 36% respectively. 33% of homeowners said taxes were too high compared to 46% of renters. Among respondents and households with total annual incomes of less than $50,000, 49% said property taxes were too high compared to 32% of respondents at the other end of the income spectrum, that is in households with total annual incomes of greater than $100,000. And there was a statistically significant difference between voters at 35% and non-voters at 45%. But the good news here is that the level of property tax sensitivity is actually quite low. In fact, I typically do not become concerned about it until the percentage who say it's too high equals or exceeds the percentage who say it's pretty fair. Looking at communications, we asked overall, how would you rate the job the best Bexley City School District does communicating with parents in the community? 74% said excellent or good. As you can see from the inset box in the upper right-hand corner, 78% among parents and 70% among non-parents. 81% of 18 to 44-year-olds rated the performance in this area as excellent or good, compared to 68% of 45 to 64-year-olds. 76% of respondents 65 and older. It was 71% with homeowners and 86% among renters. And I'm not sure why that is. I'm not sure it's necessarily even actionable information, but it was intriguing nevertheless. Looking at inbound communications, we also asked, how would you rate the job that Bexley City School District has done to listen to people like you so they feel like stakeholders whose opinions are valued by school leaders? For this particular performance rating, you're at 61%, 18% saying excellent, and 43% saying good. It was 59% for parents, but that was not statistically significant when compared with the 62% of non-parents. It was 60% for homeowners and 66% of renters, but that difference was not statistically significant. It was 60% among voters and 71% among non-voters. It was 65% among 18 to 44-year-olds, 52% among 45 to 64-year-olds, which was a substantial difference, and 70% among respondents 65 and older. Nevertheless, that was above the 50% threshold for each of the major subgroups. We also asked in a forced choice battery, which of the following would you say is the primary source for your news and information about Bexley schools? And as you can see, at 24%, district emails and mailings was top among parents at 35%, but only cited by 13% of non-parents. 19% of respondents said talking with parents or students, that was 20% among parents and 18% among non-parents. On the second plateau, 12% said reading the local weekly newspapers. That was 5% among parents, but 18% among non-parents. Also, 11% said social media, that was 10% with parents, 11% with non-parents. Reading the Columbus Dispatch was 5% overall, 2% for parents, and 9% for non-parents. Let me point out here that you've got a total of 27% of non-parents saying they're getting a primary information about the school system from traditional print media. And the reason I make that point is you can see here, there's no single dominant form of communication or no single way to reach everybody in the community. Not unusual, but this does a good job of illustrating the need for a multifaceted approach to communicating with the various publics you have. Also, visiting the school district's website was cited by 4% overall, 5% of parents, and 4% of non-parents. 13% volunteered a combination thereof, including 17% of parents and 9% of non-parents. 7% volunteered other extraneous responses, including 5% of parents and 9% of non-parents, and 5% were unsure, including 1% of parents and 9% of non-parents. Lastly, a couple of the key findings that I think are the most important to take away from the results. First and foremost, at the time the survey was conducted, there appeared to be widespread contentment and satisfaction, and there were no indications of discord with any of the various aspects that were tested in the survey. Secondly, ratings for the quality of education were exceptionally high, and you could underline that and boldface it. A little more rhetorical emphasis is probably warranted, because that really was about as high as I've seen it. And the sentiment seemed to be a consistent one throughout the community. Although there was some modest sense that the quality of education may differ among schools, did not appear to be tarnishing views of the educational product. Third, majorities of community members also exhibited satisfaction with the various aspects of the educational experiences being offered to students, and there appeared to be little concern for or attunement to reliance on technology. The reason I say that is that the percentage of respondents who were not sure was exceedingly high. Think about it, even 28% of your parents did not have enough information about this matter to form an opinion, which suggests that it's just not something that has come to their attention, and for that reason, it's not a problem or concern. Fourth, the performance rating for the job the district has done managing taxes was exceptional, and there was low sensitivity to the current rate of property taxation. And I say that because it's not licensed to raise the property tax rate. Always important point I don't want to leave to chance. Fifth, the greatest challenge facing the district may be communicating with its various publics due to the varied ways in which they've gotten their information about the schools. Despite this, the district also got high marks for communicating with the public and being receptive to its overtures and entreaties. And lastly, most importantly, the district's efforts to deliver high-quality educational product, manage its finances, and engage the public appear to have been well received by all the various segments of the community, as there were no salient indications of disenchantment among any of the groups. Think about this as a physical exam. The news is all good. You're going to live. Before I open the floor for any questions, is there anything I overlooked?
If you could explain the sample size and how that makes it
valid
and reliable.
Sure. First and foremost, I have now worked in 39 different states, including I have an extensive base of clients in California. And when I do work in places like California, and do statewide surveys, I typically will not do more than about 2,000 interviews. I have a quarterly statewide interview that I run in Ohio, and we do 800 interviews in Ohio. And when I do election work in Ohio to forecast election results, we'll do 800 interviews. And the reason I say that is 300 is probably more than adequate for a community of this size. In fact, I do 300 survey interviews in communities that are much larger. And of course, there's an additional cost involved, and there's probably not a great deal of additional precision that would be realized by expanding the survey size. Questions?
One interesting point, we talked about the taxation. We had a permanent improvement levy on our ballot over a year ago, and it passed at
73. Sure. I'm not surprised.
Yeah. It was no tax increase, but still it did sort of represent what you had up there.
One of the things that jumps out at me from the survey results is there's a high degree of trust and confidence in what you're doing, not just educating students, but also managing your resources. So I'm not surprised to hear that at all.
One question I had was the way it's presented in the document we had to look at, you know, sort of divided into, you know, positive leaning and sort of neutral and negative leaning. And in this as well, you sort of grouped you know, excellent and good in most of the results. Obviously, I think we think of ourselves as desiring to be excellent. And I guess how much weight would you give to looking at the differences between excellent and good? It's sure. Is a survey like this best at really looking at sort of broad ideas if it's generally positive, neutral, or negative? Because you know, some of them were like, you know, pretty high excellent relative to good, and others were like, well, it was 27% excellent and, you know, 40% good, and like that's a slightly different view of that.
If we had surveyed 600 respondents, I probably would look more closely at those differences. I consolidate them just to have large enough sub-selves for doing significance testing when we're comparing results by subgroups. But let me tell you, the numbers are off the chart, and I wouldn't be terribly concerned with those differences between excellent or good, especially since the data is so consistent across the board. I think all of it corroborates everything that you see throughout the survey. Other questions? Forced choice battery. We asked them what is their primary source of information. We did not ask them how often do you visit the Kansas City School District website. And the reason for that is, frankly, you've got very reliable empirical data available for that measure just by looking at website traffic. We used intentional oversampling to have a large enough parent subsample.
Okay. So when we extrapolate this out to voters, we need to think about the facts that we're not, this has more information about our parents than it does about the voters at large.
Yeah. Your adult population looks different from your parent population, and your electorate looks different from your parent population and your adult population. You're absolutely right. In some cases. But let me point out, there were a lot of instances in which there were statistically significant differences between parents and non-parents. But you're absolutely right, that's a good example of one area where probably would require some specialized knowledge.
We only
oversampled among parents,
okay.
and that changed the data a little bit, so the sample won't look like a composite of the adult population. And remember, the adult population is going to be different from the entire population as well here.
Right.
But did you weight the results towards the?
Not race. No.
Not towards race, just towards. You said the gender was one of those.
Gender. I can't remember what the other variables were. I believe we did not weigh towards race. I'm not certain, though. We had to look at the notes.
Did you say that you feel like this survey, and it's hard because it is a smaller portion of our community than some other communities, do you feel like this survey is fine enough grain that it captures those opinions and voices of our memory residents?
Yeah, I would say so in this case. I think it would be difficult to oversample non-white respondents in order to get a large enough subsample, especially if you wanted to break it down even further, just because this is a, because the demographic composite of the community. Your office last week, so it's certainly available.
I think it's more useful that way than
it is, which is why we want
But yeah,
nobody likes reading cross tabs. Many of my clients are in other states, so I'm readily accessible. If there are other meetings that you want me to participate in and present this data to any other groups you have who might be interested.
So, I'm sorry, I have one last question. Were there any other questions that got to, it seemed like from the first slide, which was about kind of what was your, what was the high priority this was your meeting, obviously special education sort of rose to the top there.
That was only at 10%, which is pretty low.
It was one of the two most common things.
There was nothing that was really extant. It's when you start seeing responses in the 20 to 30% range that you say there's a groundswell of interest or concern about a particular topic. There was nothing like that in this case.
Okay, so you, so none of the other questions got to any perceived dissatisfaction?
There were some preliminary questions we asked that are in the results, as well as the more extensive presentation that's available, talking about things like right direction and wrong track. And we use those surveys really to acclimate respondents to the survey taking process, but it serves as a social barometer to give you some idea of how restless or conversely how content people are. And again, I didn't see anything to indicate that there was any area of concern that was similar.
I would add, I guess, and correct me if I'm wrong, but when you have as high a satisfaction rating that we do, you won't see lots of, you're going to see what you work on and be pretty spread out because there is no overwhelming dissatisfaction with the school district. So you're going to see small, I think that would be consistent. The higher the rating of satisfaction, there's probably less likely to be one area or two areas that are really.
And that's an excellent point. Let me mention that you saw some respondents talking about improving education in the open-ended questions, and that's axiomatic, and it's because people, even when they're exuberant about the quality of education, will often say, well, it can always be better. And in the absence of any urgent problems, it's almost a default answer of sorts.
I think the good news for us is as we move forward, we don't have a big area to fix before we can continue to improve, and we should continue to improve. So I think that's a lot of what this information helps us to see, is there's not a glaring problem that we have to put a lot of effort into before we can move on. So that's a good thing.
Thank you for having me this evening.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Move on to our regular board reports. I'll start off. I've got a number of things I wanted to touch on. First thing is I was unable to make the athletic board meeting. Also, I know that we have board has interviews coming up for strategic planning. So I know that we have interviews scheduled. There's lots of stuff going on. But each of the board members are being interviewed this Friday.
So everyone knows here that each of the board members, we each have an hour scheduled interview to talk about strategic planning. So it's all part of the wide community catch, including board members being interviewed. Tomorrow, we have the city leadership group, which involves city people from the city, the mayor, city council president, Superintendent Miller, myself, and we get together every quarter or so. This will be my first meeting doing this, that, you know, Ms. LaPaul has participated before, that we talk about issues that citywide that overlap the school, the city, and other aspects, and it's always good to get together with leaders in that community. I'm looking forward to that tomorrow. There can be a lot of topics to discuss, so we have that tomorrow, Ms. Miller and I do. Just as on a personal note, I am going to be at Ohio State Law School on Wednesday during lunch. They asked me to participate in a discussion with a couple of the professors there that are also school board members to talk about legal careers and how that affects being on the board. And so I was, since I'm an OSU Moritz alumnus, they asked me to participate. So I get to participate with one of the professors that I had in 1991. So that'll be fun. That'll be on Wednesday. And that's about it, other than, you know, I'll let Melissa talk about the athletic work, but obviously track, field for all levels, and baseball and softball, and it's nice, beautiful weather, and of course, lacrosse going on. So lots of busy stuff going on. I know Ms. Minio was just coming from the middle school track meet, but she can't make it here. So lots of stuff going on athletically, too. So that's all.
So I have met with the BEF. We had our board meeting last month, and of course, big news is Bravo is this Saturday at St. Charles, 7 o'clock. Please come attend. It would be great to have everybody there. And also, you can log in advance online. It all tells you, but it's easy to bid. Maybe too easy, hopefully.
over 70% of the kids who participate in CSA are actually from Bexley. So that's sort of a broader connection than that. But for lots of sort of efficiency reasons, they are currently looking into forming a memorandum of understanding with CSA that sort of merge those programs. So look out for that. Also, I wanted just to sort of plug, again, I've mentioned this before, that the pool is offering a E20 membership this summer. So if you have like a middle school student who wants to go to the pool, but you don't necessarily have the time or the money to have a family membership, you can just buy a youth membership. It's the same price as the senior membership. I believe it's for students 11 and older, I think, so they'd be able to go to the pool, which is cool. Especially if a student like at home during the summer. Melissa and I met with Mr. Smith, the finance committee. We spent most of our time looking at scenarios for the upcoming teacher contract negotiations. And so I think we're going to consider that a little bit later, but I know some productive conversations and things. Mr. Smith put all the documents you pulled together for that. Arts note, Baskerville is this weekend. I think they're practicing as we speak, so I think if you have any time this weekend, if we begin, it's the 12th, 13th, and 14th. So this weekend, so get your tickets for that. And to further some of what Marla was talking about in terms of the walkout, I just wanted to commend our students for both their participation and their decision not to participate in that. The conversations I was having at home with my students and my son was having with his classmates was just really outstanding, and I think speaks to the sort of level of engagement that our students have in their schools and in their communities and in our nation. And it's just really amazing to see that sort of coming forth out of our students, you know, middle school students, high school students, and separate from all the sort of administrative things, which I really do appreciate the thoughtfulness that went into it, and just the amount of learning that I think was displayed by our students and the amount of thoughtfulness, I think was really great. And I know in our family, I can just imagine that event being something that would be really impactful for my son, you know, in his educational careers, being able to look back on. And I think that was true for a lot of students, whether they either chose to participate or chose not to, just being given an opportunity to sort of stand your ground and stand for something and kind of speak out for what you believe in. So I thought it was just a really great opportunity. I really appreciate the article that Rose, that Ms. Thomas wrote. I thought it was really a demonstration of how well our students are educated in terms of communicating and writing. That's a skill that I know I learned at Bexley, and it's definitely clear in the article. And also just like the content of this one. So.
Thank you. Ms. LaQuaff.
Yes, I'll report on the athletic board. Mr. Marlowe and myself were tag team that evening, so with my turn to go, so don't worry. And a lot of discussion was centered around participation fees for sports. Right now we have a declining scale for payments, and it's a lot of administrative and technical work, and it hasn't been increased in a very long time, and so we discussed increasing the fee plus having just one set fee. So no matter how many children you have playing, how many sports they play, it would be the same price for every sport for every child. We are, however, looking at a family cap. So it would be with multiple children, a cap would possibly apply. And our fees are certainly the lowest, if not one of the lowest, in Franklin County. So that's something else to consider. Also, we discussed a principal waiver for athletic eligibility, and we recommended the removal of one of the clauses that seem to have overlap. Now that we have study tables, we're able to monitor student grades and performance on a weekly basis instead of a quarter or report card basis. So there was a discussion and recommending to do that, and hopefully that'll happen at some point in time. That should be passed over to the department to do that. Next, again, Mr. Dennison said we met with Kyle, and you know, Kyle has been with us a year now. The amount of information that you all are privy to a lot of that, but like what you saw with Fallon, Mr. Fallon's presentation with the, you know, all the colored graphs and charts, taking a very difficult topic and making it palatable for us to kind of help us to understand. Mr. Smith does the same for us when we're looking at, you know, very, very difficult and intricate topic of teacher negotiations. And I really appreciate that because it's like mind-boggling. So Mr. Dennis and I were just kind of like, oh, okay, just put in color and we get a color guard. But anyway, so I very much want to thank him. And also I attended the special education, Ms. Mio. We both were there for the special education only to IEP parents. So if you didn't get one, unless you had an IEP student, you would not receive it. And response was fairly low, so they're going to continue to work on building a response pattern for these parents to build on information. Anyway, so that's kind of a presentation. And they do like seeing the board members there to support them, because we do offer positive feedback. And then, once again, I told you, we come to the board meeting, and we tell what's going on to the general public and the board about what goes on in the PTO meeting, so they appreciate that disbursement of information.
Thank you. Ms. Minio.
So the committee meeting that I attended this past month was the strategic, the first meeting of our strategic planning committee. Today was really exciting. I think that we have a good mix of administrators and educators. And the energy was good, and I thought that Diane from Nelly and I, like, did we, I could see where we're going, and it was, the feedback, what we did I thought was valuable, and I think the feedback, the immediate feedback was, like, beneficial. So I think it got more on to the zone. So, and I guess I do have to give a little shout out. I was sadly unable to go on Friday night, I was at work, but I know that the high school had their sleep out. And it's no. So I'm awesome. Let's get out of there.
No excuse.
Yeah. And so I haven't heard yet. I don't think, like, how would it, are you going to report on that? Okay.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, good. I was very excited, like, to see that it didn't happen, and I felt bad if you guys would go around. Okay, cool.
Tremendous TV coverage, too.
Yeah.
Yeah, really good TV.
Well, it's Thomas.
Yeah. Okay, well, on the sleep out, I'm not part of the club, but I am the student council representative for it. So I was there, I didn't sleep out because it was ridiculous. They raised more than they've ever raised in the past, which was $5,000 at the time of the event. After several donations after, they now have, I think, around $5,700. So they did really, really well on managing the event and making sure people were warm and just honestly taking care of everyone. I honestly haven't seen it go this well. And not that everyone bad, but I think that everybody did what they needed to do and did a great job. That's her sleep out, but I just wanted to say, I didn't have this on here, but I want to say that I really appreciate everyone who supported either side of the walkout. I think I saw that in students and adults. I see on social media, just being a teenager all the time, both sides kind of berating each other, and I didn't see that at all at Bexley. I saw from students and parents and teachers and staff members alike the fact that each person is entitled to their own opinion, and it was very important to the walkout planning committee that we make sure everybody feels included and doesn't feel like they have to do something, and if you didn't participate, you'd be made fun of, or if you did, you would. So I just wanted to say thank you to everybody here, and if you have any students in the schools, I can guarantee you they did a great job with handling the walkout. For student council, we have the talent show coming up pretty soon and auditions for that. We had our election
environment, and he also understands that our primary role here is developing students, and so how does technology support students and staff as we do that? So I'm excited about that. He has great knowledge, skills, and a passion for integrating technology. As I spoke with people about him, these are some quotes. He's an analytical thinker who can problem solve. One person actually said, even if you ask something crazy, he may say, I have to get back to you. He works really hard at these phrases to say yes to people, to make things work. He supports teachers and their work. He is a valued colleague. And from his superintendent, I don't want to lose him. You are. I am really excited to welcome Brad to our team. I think he's going to add quite a bit to the group and just energy and passion. So if you have anything, you want to say a few words?
Sure. First of all, I want to apologize. I was going to bring my wife and son with me, but he was sent home for preschool today with a fever. So I thought that would have been a bad first impression. No, I just want to thank Superintendent Miller and everybody who's been involved in the process. Really just everybody's been so kind. I know it'll be a few weeks before I actually get started, but I'm going to try to integrate myself as much as possible between now and then, and just can't wait to get started.
Great. Thank you.
When is the starting?
We're still working on that. Hopefully officially starting sometime maybe early June, but we certainly have some transition time. We definitely want him on board. The contract says August 1, that's standard for an administrator, but that's until we can figure out, and then we can do a revision for that. I also want to say really quickly, I informed the board of this process through the Friday reports, but just so that people know, we really take a really serious look at how we're going to hire, and so Brad was one of 41 applicants. I did phone screeners with, I believe, 10 different people, and then from the phone screeners, narrowed that down to 5. He interviewed with the committee of about 13 people, and was one of the top two candidates coming out of that, and then interviewed with me. And I actually enlisted some support from our ESC, from their technology director, to listen to the tech speak that I need to, like, somebody tell me how to interpret. And so he went through, we moved through the process at, I think, a good clip, but it was a rigorous process that he's still smiling, and he was being here, so I'm glad to have him. The second person that I'm excited to, it's not really a recommendation tonight because of the way we have to do this, this contract, but Brooke Smith, who is currently an intervention specialist at our middle school, is going to be in a role of administrative intern. So this is not an administrative position. It is a still within our teacher realm, but we will employ her through our ESC because she will be helping to evaluate staff, and so she, you'll see on here her request for a leave of absence in order to fulfill this. So I'm going to let Mr. Cottle, our middle school principal, speak a little bit more about Brooke.
I've never been so excited to talk about a leave of absence before. Usually these are to try to keep from leaving. So on the, like Ms. Miller mentioned, on the agenda tonight, you have a 1-year unpaid leave of absence for Brooke Smith, who's been an intervention specialist at the middle school for the past 8 years. And this leave is to fill the middle school administrative intern position that was proposed in February. Mrs. Smith was chosen from a field of 30 applicants, both internal and external, and was the clear-cut choice. Her experience with special education, various ages, elementary through high school, and demonstrated leadership were all assets that were just too good for us to pass up. We've heard from the community over the past year in surveys and conversations that special education is an area they would like to see focused on. By further empowering one of our most effective and influential special education staff members, I feel like this is a clear indicator that those voices are being heard. Ms. Smith has served as an informal department head, a grade level chair, a camp chaperone, a DC chaperone, and has taught alongside nearly every teacher in the building. She is well respected by her peers, both in and outside of the building. She's an effective communicator with parents that can have both the fun conversations and the not so fun ones with empathy and compassion. Ms. Smith knows what is working and what can be improved at the middle school. She has the work ethic and knowledge to help us improve. In particular, she will take a leadership role in our building response to intervention and positive behavioral intervention and supports teams. I'm excited to bring her leadership, expertise, and work ethic to support all the students in the building as well as she has supported those she has worked most closely with in the previous years. So we enthusiastically recommend her for this position.
We enthusiastically recommend that you accept her recap.
Yes, that.
I just want to say, I don't only work here, my children go here, and I love this district, and I'm really excited for the opportunity to look at it as a global scale instead of just a classroom scale, and I'm going to continue to work hard every single day to continue to make those numbers go even higher.
One thing I will say also about Brooke, one of the questions that Jason and I asked is, what would you need to do to be prepared to start in August? And so she immediately talked about what she would have to do between now and the end of the school year and then all summer. So I'm like, she knows how to be an administrator. We're excited to have Brooke in this role and really get to provide some leadership in the areas that Jason talked about. But again, knowing we really weren't sure we were ready, that we needed an assistant principal, but we knew we needed some additional support, additional students in the building, additional teachers, work in some areas around special education and response intervention. We knew that it would be a good addition for us to have. So very happy this is working. Couple of items on the agenda. Obviously, it's personnel time of year. It's April, and so you see all of the various teacher contracts on the agenda for our negotiated agreement. April is the month. One thing you'll notice is the resignation of a fourth grade teacher who's been here, I think, for a while. And but I just want you to know she's taking a job in the home district where she lives, which is on the opposite side of town. I might have lived there before. It's a long drive every day. Job postings, I've been keeping you informed about those as well. Job postings coming out if we have changes. Also, what you see is a contract for clinical education affiliation agreement between Bexley City Schools, Nationwide Children's Hospital, and Ohio State University. This is similar to a student teaching type contract. Oh, I skipped over some things, didn't I? I just skipped right over things. I'm so excited about people. I'll finish this part and then I'll go back. This is like a student teaching. So Ohio State, when students are in their athletic training program, they need to do an internship. And so they need to be placed with an athletic trainer in order to do that. Nationwide Children's Hospital accepts athletic training interns. And so one of the people that can supervise are our Nationwide Children's Hospital athletic trainers. And so this is an agreement to allow them to be able to have an athletic training intern work with them in our schools. It really is kind of a win-win for us because we get some extra help in athletic training. These are people who've completed their programming. They're just decided to allow another vendor to print that or to use that, we could. We own it, but they would, that would be consistent. Our blues would be vastly blue. We would not have multiple colors of blue. Everything would be consistent. And with the contract, in addition to those benefits, we also would get rebates. So right now, we're spending the money anyway, and we're not getting anything in return for it. So this would give us some rebates over the course of time. So, for example, let's see. Actually, it wasn't $40,000. It was $30,000 last year. We purchased last year girls and boys basketball uniforms, boys and girls baseball, boys and girls lacrosse, field hockey, and then we spent, so that was $30,000. Since we're not part of their corporate sponsorship program, we don't get any access to an online spirit shop, which we can also run at no additional cost to us. The online spirit shop, they have all Nike equipment or apparel. We can use other vendors. Again, we are still able to have other vendors print shirts or whatever that we ask them to do. But the online spirit shop, would really, it's a nice benefit. It's sometimes maybe a little higher end, different types of apparel. So if you're running a physical spirit shop, which we want to also have, you have limited numbers of things that you can carry. This would be if one person wants to order a quarter that they could. It also is nice for family members, or great, you know, grandparents who maybe live out of state or out of town and want to get something for their family member, they can order it. Or our alumni who are spread all over the place, if they wanted to get some spirit wear, Bexley Spirit Wear, they would have access through this. So that's the big overview of that particular contract.
Just real quick, and that's just how what we purchase through the school, and then it's available. This doesn't prevent teams from doing their own.
No.
This is just what we purchase for uniforms and our official
right.
purchases for equipment and uniforms. And
right.
So each individual teams that they do their own sweatshirts and yep. hats and all that, yep. they still control all that.
Yeah, we're not, this is not our, they're our exclusive provider for our athletic equipment and our apparel, but for the team, apparel means uniforms. Apparel being uniforms, other types of spirit wear, that sort of thing. So again, we can license those, we can allow, we can contract with anybody else that we want to do those things.
Or would you rather me wait for a question until we talk about later first? I just had a question. Longstanding issue of mine is our logo, in that it is Short Lines logo. Not from being a creative person who property is not very clean from my perspective. If we were going to go through this process, would we be able to develop our own actual unique logo so that it's not, is that something we can, because I need to like,
I think
this contract.
BSN is going to let us use the Lion logo. I
don't have the answer for this because yeah. I wasn't sure, I didn't know those were questions
yeah.
ahead of time, so I didn't ask that. I believe that the thought was it would be that similar Lion logo that we've been using. Similar to the Detroit Lions logo, but it's not exactly. If you want me to find out if we can do something different, I can certainly look into that.
I think we use like a couple different logos across the spectrum of sports.
We do, and that's part of this would be then we would have one because that would be
one. Yeah, and I think just in that effort, we're gonna, especially if we're going to have it for your contract and we sort of own the logo, it seems like a perfect opportunity to go ahead and take the step to say, let's spend a little bit of money hiring a graphic designer or whoever it might be to develop a logo that's specifically needs of Exit that's not based on a corporately owned brand.
I think that that's what I look at it, that they have like their own, they've already developed that. I think that that's what it was, that they have that. But it's obviously not using it.
Superintendent Miller, I can speak to that.
Thank
after
you.
Having conversations with Eli and going through this. There's a, with the Detroit Lions logo, there's a 10% variation that would make it so that it doesn't get into copyright or infringement. As far as the rebranding and changing the Lion, you can get into extreme costs when you look around the building and you see how many actual Detroit Lions logos are on things, or on varsity jackets, and then schools have to determine, are we going to pull back everything that has that Lions logo on it and start new? Or are we going to slowly bring stuff back? And then you also deal with the big community pushback on that we're no longer having this lion is our logo. So now there's juniors who are going to be seniors that their varsity jacket's no longer any good because it has the lion on there, and now we're moving with new. So Eli said that it's just a very complicated process to completely change your brand. But I believe that BSN is open to suggestions on changing that.
So it's possible that based upon Eli's assessment, it may not be recommended.
Correct, because it's costly.
Is only used on our football uniforms.
And it's posted on some other places around the building.
Right.
So it pops up more than we think when we start to look. But yeah.
There are variations from years. I mean, sweatshirt I got in elementary and one my dad had aren't the same.
Right.
Right.
Some of that comes about because there was never an official logo. So part of this is getting an official logo. I think my question is, do you want me to have us look into something different or to stay with what we have?
Why can't we have students?
We can say, well, I meant how long.
We tried that once and it didn't work. That's what happened the last time. But
we can do two. We have a lot of lions that we do use in various sports. If we compiled them all and found one that exists that we do like, not we, I mean the athletic department or whoever's going to make that decision, we don't have to reinvent the wheel. I think we have some pretty nice lines. We just have too many of them. And I mean, even our pennants are different. I mean, and that's just because we don't want to make them
consistent.
It's essentially the Detroit Lion.
Yeah.
Put that.
Yeah. So I would like something unique. I think we're.
So is this something that you are wanting to approve the logo? Because it
rather says something new.
Yeah. I know. Just in historic perspective, that this board did approve the rearranging of the district. So I think it's
okay.
To follow that.
I just want to make sure I follow the process. Get money back and to make it a lot better, and then we can start adding to that. I think that's where I want to be focused, what we're talking about. So to make sure I'm clear, you want me to look into maybe moving forward with the current logo, but look at can we change that logo, and if we can during the course of this contract, how will we find that out?
I don't want to hold anything up. I would want to hold up the efficiencies of the contract, but if there's something about in order to engage the contract, we have to agree on what this logo is that we're going to own and copyright, then I would push it to do that before we start.
Would we be able to change the logo once we get into the contract?
I don't know that. I could have looked into that ahead of time, but that's a tough question, so you'll have to decide if you want to approve the contract.
To that point, I don't
know. I just don't know if once they go to the effort of creating it and making sure that it's not going to be copyright infringement, if they're going to be willing to change it during the course of the contract. That's what I don't know.
They haven't even discussed a logo yet, or they haven't even gotten that far in their discussions
right.
yet. So.
Okay. But if we know we want a different logo, it's just a matter of timing, because getting different options, if you want to approve it, then that's going to take time, and then I don't know, it could end up. I don't know. the authorization to accept resignations. This is something really we should have had on in January, but again, it's personnel time, so it becomes clear. What this authorization does, it allows me to accept a resignation and be able to post a job without waiting potentially a month for a board meeting. When you're competing for staff members, you don't want to be a month behind, especially now that we're in April. So there's an authorization that if someone turns in a resignation, I can accept it and post the position. And then the last thing that's on here, it's not on my PowerPoint, I apologize, but on the board agenda, I'm sorry to keep it in the last one, I can read. There is a recommendation for a job description. I'm not recommending a person, but I am recommending a new job description that we do not have. Throughout the course of this year, since my hire, you've asked me, what do you need to move us forward? What do you need to help us to be more successful? And I've used, as you know, I've been saying, I need to think about it. I'm really watching. I'm gathering data. I'm looking at information. And I've been keeping track of specific areas where we are in need of some work. Some of it being because we're also now embarking upon strategic planning, then we'll be implementing a strategic plan, and we're trying to do some things that we haven't been working on in the past. And so a lot of the things that I listed, or that I have been listing, as I've been keeping track, were work in the areas of human resources and also student operations. And so human resource work, the management of licensure and staff evaluations and the OTES and ETPES systems, not evaluating the principals do that, but the systems and maintaining those systems and making sure that things called linkages are done and the different components of that system. We have a staff code of conduct policy, but we do not have a handbook. Most businesses, most organizations do have a staff handbook so that it's clear what the expectations are for your employees. So that is missing, and it would be something that I would recommend that we develop. Just staffing, constantly monitoring our numbers. As you remember from our Ohio Facilities Commission report, or Ohio Facilities, yes, Commission, Construction Commission report, there was a enrollment projection component of that, and we are projected to enroll over 400 new students over the next 8-9 years, although some of us are feeling like they're all enrolling right now. I'll remind you, we had to add a kindergarten section at Castleton Elementary 2 weeks after we opened kindergarten enrollment. We already have more kindergartners in Castleton for next year than we have this year. And so we're enrolling, so just monitoring that on a regular basis and then looking at open enrollment requests and some of those things that come through. So there's quite a bit of work in the human resource field, just managing. Now that we're doing online applications, which is so much better, there's an oversight and management of that and making sure that people that qualify to move forward in the process actually move forward in the process and be there, what are called folders, and it's all online. Quite a bit of work in this area. It's a lot of operational work. Enrollment, in addition to enrollment, I think it would be more effective for us to have a centralized enrollment rather than parents having to go to 2 or 3 different buildings. They can go to 1 for enrollment. That also helps us with consistency in gathering the paperwork that we need. Now, the online registration system helps with that, but centralized enrollment is more user-friendly for parents, but it also, again, streamlines our process, and we don't find that we have one system in one building and another system in another building, which can lead to some difficulties. Monitoring residency can become quite an involved situation when you have residency, so that's another area. We don't have too much of this, thankfully, but moving into the student area, suspension and expulsion hearings. Let me back up on human resources. Title IX oversight, instances of discrimination, that sort of thing. And then the suspension and expulsion. Currently, Dr. Lipset manages those things. And I've said many times, she's a one-person academic department. It doesn't matter if you have 16,000 students or 2,400 students, you have the same number of curriculum areas that you have to constantly be monitoring. Anytime something comes along with student or staff discipline or Title IX, she literally has to stop working on the academic work to manage that because it has to be handled right away. And so it creates difficulties for us in moving forward with some of the academic work that we interpretation sometimes of those procedures. We had an administrator meeting last week, and it came very quickly, all the principals had a slightly different view of some things. It's not their fault, but there isn't somebody to really oversee that and ensure that our interpretations are consistent. And then the next step being that we drill consistently, that we do lockdown drills, and we do, just like we do fire drills and tornado drills, but we do those things consistently, and that students and staff and visitors to the building know what to do. And so somebody who can kind of oversee that and sort of work in conjunction with John Eikenberry, but then take it to the training level at the buildings and be able to be the person who says, yes, students know. I used this example earlier with some of our PTO presidents. If we were to have students from Maryland or Montrose come to our building for, say, a play, and we had to have a lockdown, I'd want, even though the facility is different, that they know the procedures and they would know how to behave regardless of what building they were in. That's one of the ways we keep students safe, just as when you get on an airplane, they go through the safety procedures, because you have to review them. We haven't done as much of that in the past, I think, as we probably should be doing moving forward, so I see that this person could really help with that. There's a number of safe schools trainings and things that have to take place that this person could take on as well, and athletics, I think, falls within this area as well, 7-12 athletics. So currently that's living with the high school principal, but there's the middle school component, and being that we have a lot of middle school sports too, as Mr. Powell can tell you. So this is a kind of a comprehensive look, and as you ask me what are the needs, these are areas of need that we have as a district. So not sure where we'll go with it, but I wanted to put together a job description and put that before you.
What's the title? Job description.
The job description is Director of Staff and Student Operations. That's a long explanation, I know. And I'll back up really quick before I turn it over to Mr. Smith to give you an update on strategic planning. As Ms. Minio said, we've already had our first planning team. They met on March 23rd. Board interviews are on April 19th. We'll be inviting 300 people to participate in focus groups. We will run 8 different focus groups, 2 for parents, 2 for staff, 2 for students. 1 is middle school, 1 is high school. And 2 for community members. And those will begin on April 19th, and those will be completed by May 3rd. Of course, we invite more people than we need to attend those, but we want to make sure that we have those. In addition, we will have surveys. All staff members, classified and certified, will receive a survey. All parents will receive a survey. And 750 non-parent, non-staff adult residents will receive a survey. So. In addition to that, we will have at least 2 open community meetings where anyone can come to give feedback. And so the process that we went through last week was starting to look at those draft themes and responding, and then those have been updated, and that they will be similar, and that things will be put out to focus groups and through the community through surveys, and people will be able to respond, and that information is taken back and continued to revise the process. So that's the first part. The leadership team, the full administrative leadership team, will be interviewed and be part of this process as well. And the plan is to, by August, have a what I'll call a foundational strategic plan to present to the Board of Education. That would include mission, vision, 3-year goals, annual objectives for those goals, and that would take us through the next 3 years. That doesn't end, it's not where the work will end, because, for example, there will certainly be something around safe schools. There will be certainly something in there around integrating technology. So once we have that basic structure, then it will be, well, what's the technology plan? Mr. Pettit has his first assignment with me to develop a comprehensive technology plan to support the strategic plan. And from a facility standpoint, we have to either maintain, renovate, or build, or combination of those. You have buildings, you have to have a facilities plan. So Mr. Eikenberry will end up getting to pull a group together and say, okay, what's the facilities plan to meet the strategic plan? So while a strategic plan will be, I call it a foundational strategic plan in August, then there will continue to be work to do. So I know that's a lot of information, but there is a lot going on. There's a lot to do and a lot going on, but it's all really good work too. So.
Awesome. Sure, that's it?
I don't know.
So like I've been saying over the last few months, property taxes have been rolling in. We've got our final report for this very first half. And again, I'll remind you that property taxes are collected on a calendar year basis, which straddles our fiscal year, our fiscal year is June 30. So normally, by this time every year, we receive about 54% of the property taxes for the calendar year. The remaining half comes in July and August. This year, that is at 60% of expected receipts for the calendar year, so it's a 6% bump. That equates to $1.272 million better than forecasted this year. I'll caution you, that's not additional money. It's just been kind of shifted into this first half of the year. So the next fiscal year, we'll see a reduced amount on the forecast line. I'll adjust that in the May forecast. So it's hard to safely assume why that occurred. I think my assumption is because of the tax law changes that happened in December, there's different ways you can deduct your liability, and property taxes is one of those. In the tax law, that there's a limitation to that deduction. So that pushed some people to pay in advance or pay in 2017 for their property taxes now. So that's why I believe we've seen an increase this first half of the year. Not all communities are like that, but I think it's one unique aspect of our community. And then looking ahead, we'll have our final income tax payment for the fiscal year on April 30th. Just a reminder, we've been seeing a lot of refunds, and it's also tax season. So this payment in April is going to be primarily for the tax filers who filed in January and February pretty early, but it is one of our larger payments, and it'll kind of give us a flavor of how many refunds if the refund story is going to be continuing like we've been seeing this whole fiscal year, which is really put a hit on our income tax receipts. I'll have a report in May for that. And that's all.
Mr. Smith. Dr. Lipset.
President Barnum, members of the board, I am seeking approval for business consent agenda item 8F. But before I give you the details for that, I'd like to share with you that the Ohio State tests are underway and are going well. Vexley's testing started on April 3. The state testing starts with students in grade 3. All of our tests are online. For all testing, the state gives us the testing windows. They give you one for English language arts, and then they'll give you another for math, social studies, and science. And we are required as a district to select 15 consecutive days to test, and that includes makeups within that 15-day time frame. Our testing, as I said, started on April 3 and will be ending on May 11, so a little over a month of testing. And the results of the state test will be there's an update there. My item for tonight is item 8F, again under the business consent agenda. I'm requesting approval to purchase a new grade 6 through 8 math text series. It's called Illustrative Math. For the past year, the grade 6 through 8 teachers have been meeting together. They've been reviewing multiple resources aligned in particular to the standards for mathematical practices, which serve as the foundation for all math standards. The mathematical practices, I wrote about these in the last board report to you. I submitted that to you last Friday. These skills and mindsets are what educators should be developing in their students. The grade 6 through 8 teachers believe that illustrative math is a best choice. It's supported by high ratings in national independent studies, and this resource has many salient features. Some to include, there's built-in differentiation for accelerated learners, for those below grade level benchmarks, as well as English language learners. There are real-world applications for students. There are comprehensive resources for learning at home, and these include videos, as well as digital tools. And as I report on the slide, that illustrative math is advised, and the authors incorporated feedback from 175 teachers across six different school districts in order to inform the newest version. So on the handout that's posted on AF, I'm presenting to you an estimated cost for a four-year adoption. This includes paper and digital text, and we're using current numbers of students who grades 5 through 7 and current number for, or current staff member numbers as well. Questions about any all? One MAP test, which is called K2, and then the other is the growth test. And we typically have our grades, actually we have our grades 2 through 5 students take that. But yes, it includes all the other grades.
Oh. So this, on G, that the purchase is at, we're adding grades 6 and 7?
It's for the illustrated MAP?
No, for the purchase of the
We are adding grade 6 and 7. This year we only tested in grades K-5, and years previously we also included grade 6, but grade 6 moved up to the middle school, so we didn't test the middle school. But next year we will be testing up to grade 7, which will be fabulous because we'll have that longitudinal data for both ELA, English Language Arts and Reading, and Mathematics.
You may recall we added the PSAT 8-9 for 8th graders. Stay with MAP from 7 and then switch over to the PSAT 8-9, and that takes students into high school. So we just have a gap here.
Are we starting to see now that we've had that? Are we starting to look longitudinally at that data? Or is it, or are we, I guess, pulling any data out of it?
Yes.
The student specific data?
Yes, and this year we're getting even better because we've had an on-site consultant. Written about that in my board report. We've had 3 days set aside to work with a woman named Candy Fowler. She's a principal at a high school that's been using MAP data for over 10 years. So she's been providing that support. So part of that professional development winter is to look at her data over time. We have our last MAP training on May 5th, so it's coming up for the school year.
Fire report. I've been in the process of forming a task force to assist in reviewing the district's current safety action plans prior to resubmitting the plan to the state of Ohio for renewal by July 1st. Just this morning, my final participant that I've been pursuing tirelessly said yes. He had no choice. I informed those of the Superintendent Miller to review, and afterward, the next step will be to set up agendas and meetings. This group features Bexy. Community members and stakeholders who work in the fields of safety, security, police, fire, military, or education sectors. So, Superintendent Miller speaks of drills and drilling with more fidelity. You have state limits, so prior it was the main focus, prior senior was fire drills each month. Tornado drills would kick in March, April, May. After Sandy Hook, they reduced fire drills and put in 3, let's call them safety drills in the sense of lockdown, evacuation, that nature. So certainly what we do, we comply with the law, but to be actually better, there's more things you can do. the information when you're looking at a task force on safety plans, that is that bold leap. This is protected information, so typically if you ask anybody in operations, hey, let's share our plans, they'd say no. But to get cohesiveness, to use resources in your community, this is exactly Bexley Bold. Yes, the information will be sequestered, but to go through a process with community of experts, not just anyone, but with experts in our community, this is exactly how you want to proceed. So this is what will happen. Luckily, I was able to get my firefighter this morning, so we'll continue onward. But it is a bold step. Any operations person will say, I'm not sharing anything with you, but, you know, that's exactly what you want. So we're moving in the right direction with that. And then with that, I'll take questions.
Before you long are on the task force?
Right now, of my experts, like 12, and then the VDA gave me designees. So add another-ish, and I'm right around 30. So, definitely a good sized group. After Sandy Hook, AG DeWine put in rules. You work with your security consultant firm, so it's all legitimate and it's all in security consultant firm English. In being able to look at a couple other plans or at least snippets of other people's plans, it's more fluid. And so that's exactly what you want if you have to enact something, is fluidness, so that people can commit to their memory and not be looking at a piece of paper when they need to. So that'll be the end run on this, is concise, burn it into your memory, and pull it out when you need it. Yes, you'll have helper things like we have our go bags and that kind of thing, but what the goal is short and sweet, to the point, and then when you need it, put it into play. We'll move forward with that. In those folks are a team that we assemble here. So you enact that team. So what you really want to do is solidify that team. We've added resources here in the recent years. So make sure, go back through and make sure as we review this that all the correct resources are there. This is. And then the reason you have safety, security, fire, military, this is drill. This is writing of drill. But obviously that component that you speak of is massively important. You just want to, just like your reunification points. Periodically, about two times a year, I'll call those spots. So far the churches haven't moved out of Bexley, but you know, you don't want to just show up. So it's circling back and plugging into that kind of thing on a more frequent basis. So it wouldn't be with those folks necessarily on the drills, but you definitely want to solidify
part of the plan. Yeah.
That they're in play and that they're
solidifying.
They know, yeah, they know they're part of that plan.
If I may add,
yes.
Agree. I think that's a really good question. Safety management is something that we know what most districts have are crisis teams. That if you have to enact something, they know that's something we also need to have in place. may not be something that happens at school, it could be something that happens in the community.
Sure.
We're supporting our students and our staff. So actually, Laysan Smith is looking at that as well. So the we will, it's another, again, it's another one of those places where the position I talked about can help oversee and make the connections of the different pieces, which is a little bit of what we're missing. So good question, and another area that we would fill that hole.
And is this part of, I think it was about 3-year review, safety review, this is part of that?
This is correct.
This is the 3-year.
This is the 3-year review. Okay. I understand we do things periodically, always sort of looking at
annual,
this,
yeah.
But this is something that's
correct.
Full-blown review of our
results, right?
Okay, thank you.
That brief note, I would like to introduce Trisha Gottstetter and Anna Ramsen, so they can come up and present their designs to you.
Thanks, guys. We'll try to make this quick. So, yes, I'm Trisha Gottstetter. I'm a Maryland parent. Anna Ramsen, our PTO president, joins me, and Lara McKenzie, who headed up our fundraising committee for the playground. So, quickly, and many of you may already know this, but with anticipation of getting the new safety surface installed in Maryland's front kindergarten playground, as we refer to it, or the front playground, PTO have been approached earlier this fall to make the structural changes this summer, if we agree it was also needed. Some of the existing, and sorry, James is showing you new renderings. The old playground equipment, 3 of the pieces, the monkey bars, the swings, the turning bars, are original to the school. It's from 1950. And then the post and platform structure is what they call the plastic slide center structure, is from 98. So it has done its time, 20 years old. And so we met with the same manufacturers that Cassingham did last year and looked at new design plans, which is what you're seeing now. And we chose Playworld, who also did the black back playground 10 years ago when Marley spearheaded Maryland's back playground renovation. Playworld also has done Montrose's playground, so we are confident they can do a good job for us. The other thing they helped incentivize us with, they will do the install for us, so we will not be doing a community build project. And since this is a smaller playground, they can knock it out with also installing the floor. It seems like a pretty seamless process to just allow them to do that. So we want to take advantage of that promotion, which is why we're actually coming to you guys tonight to get approval to go ahead and carry out with the purchase order and have Kyle help us with that later on this week. So where we are right now, PTO, we technically have $52,000 in hand for the project. If you go down to the cost section, the total project is $62,000. Of that, $4,600 of benches, tables, and a trash can that we could hold off and wait on. But we'd like to go ahead and be able to purchase that at the same time. So, and the playground equipment is $57,000. That includes the install, and includes the needs for their or complete the project. So right now, in order to process the order, we'll need $28,000 or half the cost, given to Playworld on Friday. And so that's why we're looking for approval to go ahead and carry that out. What Lara can speak to too, we are waiting on just 2 final grants from Bexley Education Foundation, Bexley Community Foundation, that will help us get to our final number. So you do see that at the bottom of my expense sheet, it shows where we're at about $9,000 short right now. We're confident both the grants would totally complete that. We also have PTO funds to use should we come up short. But basically, I'm telling you guys tonight, we really feel confident we have 100% of the funds.
PTO certainly has the missing piece in the bank, and so we discussed it at the last PTO meeting that if the PTO would make a contribution in any case to the playground. So,
and yes, please look at the renderings. As far as the color scheme goes, we decided to copy, or I shouldn't say copy. We were going with the same colors used on the Cassingham
some of the Bexley blue, but also green and gray and neutral as well. Oh, yes. No, just so you guys know, we did get input from our teachers, parents, the kids. We had a community meeting with the kindergartners where they shared ideas. A lot of asks for a water slide.
You just say when it's raining, it's a water slide.
That's right. The other fun thing we did, we had the entire school vote on some pieces of equipment where the kids, kindergarten to fifth grade, watched some YouTube videos of the equipment being used, and then they all voted on a ballot for which item they wanted, and these play cubes that you see ended up winning. And while those may not necessarily look like something big in person, or sorry, in the CAD, in person, the tallest cube is at 6 feet. And COSI just installed these on their new playground in the front, and they really are fun. We had the kids test out every bit of equipment that you see here. I drove my kids all over the city having to try new school playgrounds because I wanted to make sure we liked everything we were installing. So.
Have you heard from any of the neighbors?
Sorry?
Have you heard from any of the neighbors about our
colors and things?
Yeah. Are you talking to anybody yet?
You know, we have not yet. We do go to, you know, Bexley Architectural Review Board on Thursday. So we'll want to get their sign off. Some of the direct neighbors do attend the schools. So they're very much aware of the plans, but we haven't received any bad feedback. Yeah.
So you said that you're going through architecture review on Thursday. Is that the only approval you have to go through with the city in terms of getting moving forward?
It is. I have not. John, did you have any additionals?
Yes, I've shared all the info with Kathy Rose, and part of their process is to reach out to anybody around the project, scope of work, so they would have done that process. Typical BZA process.
And just because I'm somewhat less familiar with Maryland than Montrose, obviously, is this actually just for kindergartners, or what?
No, that's a great question. So during the school day, it is only utilized by kindergartners in their afternoon recess time. Before, after, it is used by everyone. It's a popular neighborhood playground as well.
Preschool.
Yes, so.
Now that we only go in on the front entrance of the school too, it's utilized a lot. Because kids, that's where we congregate in the morning, and that's where people are entering the school.
Is there an entrance now from the,
I'm sorry, I didn't include all photos in your packet, Marlon.
No,
I have more up here.
We have them on our.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
So the two entrances, you have an entrance, a gate right here,
okay.
A small gate, no gate, but an opening that's actually here, and then another, some steps up to the playground that are here. So we have three, only one that has a real true gated closure right now.
Sorry, I was just, so, in the morning, you're talking about, you only go through the front door now.
Mm-hmm. So my kids actually get out of my car and they run across here to get to the front of the building.
Okay, good.
So I guess question on that, I know like the, again, I'm only saying this because I'm familiar with it, it's literally a problem for me. The Montrose playground is gated and secure all the way around the perimeter. Is there any concern? I mean, obviously this is the existing condition of the gate. So A, are the fences being replaced as part of this, or are they in working condition, and do we feel confident about the security?
Are we confident about security overall? There's assessments that we looked at. So like on the western side of Maryland itself, it's wide open. the parking lot, to the playground, to the bus. So that's hope.
That makes it, I don't know, it just makes me a little nervous that it's kindergartners out there and there's, seeming from my understanding, what we're talking about, a gap that goes straight up to the street.
No, well, there's an opening right here that's our largest opening. And it's true, when John and I have talked, I had told him, the kindergarten teachers said they weren't opposed to having either a gate or something that did close off at least this one opening that does open up to Remington. This one's a little smaller and a little more protected. We were even thinking about it as we were installing this toss-up, because we were thinking about balls rolling out and different things. But, and that was one of the reasons why we put this in the corner here, to eliminate as many balls rolling into the street. But, and so we would not be opposed to closing that off or making it more secure.
Yeah, I mean, it might be a completely separate thing than what you're asking for a little while. I was just casually talking about this as a thing.
And the
definitely might be spoken about this. Fencing would be a different phase, but certainly maintainable. And then I would put the ADA flooring in my budget as we have with the other playgrounds.
So the fencing, the chain link fencing is not in?
It's correct. It's not part of the.
And certainly, if we were to change that, that would be part of the district responsibility, not a DTO.
Correct. Very much so. It's
yeah.
Now, PTO, we certainly said, as we're putting this beautiful new playground in, it doesn't look great to have an old fence that actually right now has wood boards across the bottom of it.
Gap between where the fencing ends and where the mulch and everything has settled. So I'm no expert on installing surfacing, but I suspect that gap might be more prominent once the new surfacing goes in.
Mm-hmm.
Given that there's already boards that are kind of blocking the gap now.
But, okay.
And any other questions? I have a totally non-sequitur question. It's a major Maryland elementary logo.
We were laughing it as you guys were talking about logos, because we went through a lot of logo redesign this past fall. And you wouldn't believe how many Maryland options we went through. A very talented parent, Sarah Spray, a graphic designer at Maryland, did that for us.
Looks great.
Thanks.
It's over here for the.
That's right. She has three boys that will be coming through next week. I'm sure she can be persuaded to help.
Also, I'd like to buy one of the shirts that has this little
thing. Yes. We have a spirit sale going on right now.
I will send you the link.
I think Kim has one.
I do. I have a shirt for almost every school. I'm worried, but I live in North Texas, so I guess I'm walking around in North
Texas. Okay, so, and since I've never asked the board for approval, so what's the true formal way to get a yes across the board?
It's on the
agenda. We'll approve it.
God. Thank you.
You can hang around and wait for our vote.
Okay.
I'll tell you if you go.
Or I'll get to it. Okay, no, thank you guys.
Thank you.
To conclude my report, please allow me to introduce Josh Krebich to you. Josh is with SAP Design, and he will present the OFCC's audit data about our facilities and translate it in concise as possible manner. Thank you,
Jeff. Thanks, John. I appreciate it. It's kind of a tall order. Thanks for allowing me to come and present to you tonight. I think John has probably handed you some documents or sent you some PDFs along with the executive summary. Obviously, our goal tonight is to take the 100-page assessment and try and sort of pare it down to the important information that we think is going to be important to you as you're moving forward. I applaud the district. You're going through a very interesting time in your district. You're pulling together a lot of information. And I think it was wise of you to go to the commission and work with them to work through their assessment program. I know that there's some challenges with that. I know that it may ultimately not lead to you partnering with the state, but it's good information for you to have. And there is a new program that I'm going to talk to you about a little bit. I'm not sure if Eugene shared the alternative program with you, but I'm going to talk to you about that just briefly. Our goal as architects, we work with a number of school districts, obviously, throughout the city, and ultimately, I work a lot up front with school districts in trying to sort of parse through all this information, both with the enrollment projections, the facility assessments, and putting together master plans. And so this is sort of what I do a lot of, and so hopefully I'm able to sort of pare this down. Just looking through the assessment review, looking at the renovation impacts, and then to get some questions for you and talk about sort of what we might recommend to you as far as next steps are concerned is really what my focus will be tonight. So again, my goal is to take this, this 200-plus page document with all of the different charts and information that's provided and try to get that down to sort of a two-page document that really gives you the meat of what the commission has come up with in regards to your master plan. And so I know that you guys should have copies of all this good stuff. And if you have any questions at any point in time, please feel free to stop me. I try to focus in on some very specific language that really would form sort of a yes or a no in regards to your master plan and partnering with the state. You know, some of the things that we obviously see is obviously the state and local shares. The state share obviously is on the extremely low side. And again, because of your district valuation, your ranking of 558 out of the 611 school districts in the state. Your enrollment projections, you receive draft enrollment projections, and obviously it's showing growth everywhere from, I think right now you're currently roughly 2461 and growing to 2941 in 2027. That 2027 becomes your planning year. So ultimately what the commission does is they look 10 years past and they look 10 years forward, right? They use a third-party enrollment projection expert to go through that. Their goal is sort of trying to understand, based on your enrollment, what the year will be in the next 10 years that would be the day where you're going to have the highest student enrollment and try and prepare for that. And so, for instance, with districts that are declining, if you think about the student enrollment projection, the day that you start school in that building would be the day that would be your highest school enrollment. But because you're growing, because you're growing, obviously, the 10-year projection is going to be the day of sort of highest student enrollment. So that starts to form some understanding of the master plan and how the master plan is going to be produced. And so that ultimately sets your planning year, which is that next line down there in the 2027-2028 planning year, which would be 10 years out. The other things that we try to capture, the cost set that the commission is using, because that's important, it factors into understanding what their co-funding for that given year and what they're not co-funding. And then we also try to capture some acronyms here, the OSDM, the Ohio School Design Manual, which again forms a lot of the information as to how your buildings were assessed in regards to whether to renovate or build new. And finally, we try and capture the Ohio Basic Building Code year. There's been a significant change in the building code that occurred just this past fall, which was the addition of storm shelters into new facilities. So that's any facility that you add on to or that you build new, there's a new requirement to have storm shelter spaces basically in that facility. This doesn't affect renovations, it only affects new construction. But what you're going to see is that you're seeing a hit for that in your renovation costs. The storm shelters are being factored as part of your renovation.
What is this storm shelter? What is
that? The thinking behind the storm shelter is that you need to provide adequate square footage for all of the occupants of the building, that's full-time occupants, in any facility, and that includes students and staff, and provide them a safe shelter that can stand roughly 250 mile per hour winds for a sustained, I think it's either 90 minutes or 2 hours. And it needs to also have its own mechanical system, it needs to be on a generator, and there need to be restrooms provided. And so ultimately that's a new component of the building code that we're all sort of trying to learn the nuances of. That is correct. Now, what you will see as part of your assessment is that they've actually added that onto your renovated spaces as well, and that's because as they're learning about the code and the implications of the code, they went to a conservative approach as opposed to waiting until they sort of knew the full sort of influence of how that was going to be applied. And so this is something that's actually been adopted. This has been in place in Kansas and Iowa and other states that have dealt, obviously, with tornado events on a more significant basis than we have. And so we're learning from them, and those requirements are really being, we're we're trying to understand those requirements as we move forward. So that is something that you are going to see as we look at some of the cost impacts. Finally, the last couple of things on the first page here that we're talking about. I know that you were reviewed under the Classroom Facility Assistance Program. You're going to hear me mention CFAP. That was the assistance program that your assessments were done under. There is another OSFC program that may be a program that you might be interested in or might be eligible for, and that's the Alternative Facility Assistance Program, which is AFAP, and I'll explain the sort of differences between the two. As far as the renovations that were concerned, again, trying to capture sort of at a high level, the renovations that came back from the state were to renovate your elementary schools, both all of Cassiacam, Maryland, Montrose elementary schools, and to size those to house about 434 PK-5 students. So again, the idea is to try to get each one of those facilities to house about the same number of students so that they can be sort of looked at equally, if you will. And then to renovate the middle school, high school to house 1,638 612 students. And so what they're doing there is they're taking your 2027 enrollment projection and basically dividing that up and looking at the grades and the number of students that can be housed in that facility and trying to come up with equal numbers. And you'll see obviously that there's impacts in each one of the facilities due to the size, because all three of the elementary schools are not the same size, right? They don't all have the same facility allowances. You do have some building specific allowances and some project agreement LFIs. I'm going to explain these a little bit more in detail, but these are sort of key components that we look at when we're working with school districts to try and understand what the impacts are working with the state. Again, the state is looking at your district, just like they look at all 611 school districts in the overall state. They're trying to build equity across all districts, and so they're applying the rules and regulations just as they have in every district that they've worked with. And so there are impacts to a district that's looking at renovation. And some of those impacts, this building-specific allowances, for starters, there's a swing space allowance, lead allowance, and the storm shelter allowance that I mentioned before. The swing space allowance is really basically for you to be able to put modulars outside of your building so that as you're renovating any one facility, you can move the kids into the modulars, do the renovation of that area, and then move the kids back into the building as those are completed. The lead allowance is really it's a state mandated allowance that focuses on sustainability, and its focus is actually on energy efficiency. And so that was an actual state mandated 3% that was added to every project budget. And so it's still broken out as a specific allowance. Where the difficulty comes, I think those are pretty easy to understand, but I think the difficulty comes in the project agreement, LFIs. LFI is a local funded initiative. It's something that the district has to pay 100% of. There is no co-funding, so there's no state and local share. The project agreement LFIs are really where a district gets hit when you're looking at renovating facilities that are of any age, effectively, and so it starts to influence each of your buildings. And I'm going to talk about the three components, which are excess square footage, oversized square footage, and then ultimately what would be considered non-compliant or non-recognized OSDM spaces. The design manual doesn't recognize certain spaces of which you have some in each of your buildings. And so I'll talk in more detail about that, and I'll also talk about the cost impact. And then ultimately, I tried to capture sort of the overall master plan cost. And so again, you see from the CFAP, the Classroom Facilities Assistance Program, co-funded cost, you would be looking at $38.7 million, of which $3 million would be state, $35.6 would be local. And then that project agreement LFI, again, which I'll go into more detail about, is $6.5 million. And I think that's critical. We're going to come back and talk about why that dollar amount is probably the main driver as to why I don't think working with the state and CFAP is probably a smart idea. And then ultimately, the final project cost is $45.2 million. And you can see the breakout between the state and local shares. That alternate facility assistance program, that's a brand new program. It's just been initiated as of last summer. It was in the most recent update of the design manual. That is a program that ultimately is geared towards school districts like yours who are thinking about doing some master plan, component of their master plan, but ultimately probably not going to work with the state because either the state and local share matches don't work out or that project agreement LFI is in a bad sort of percentage, if you will, or proportion, if you will. And so there is the opportunity to potentially take advantage of some monies from the state, which would be 10% of the state share of your master plan, or $1 million, whichever is greater. And so right now, 10% of your overall master plan would be about $300,000. And so $1 million obviously would be the greater of the two, and that would be what you would be eligible for. Now, what I will say is we don't have any school districts currently that have worked through this program, so we don't know how it's going to be applied. So it's brand new, and we still don't quite understand all the nuances of how that program is going to operate. But that is something that you may potentially look at, potentially at taking advantage of. And so you needed to go through this whole master planning effort to even be eligible for it. So that is a benefit to you. In your buildings summaries, or in your executive summary, if you will, I've included summaries for each of the buildings individually. And some of the things that I've captured and that I think are important that that you need to understand is that the state has sort of identified the oversized square footages and the excess square footages at each facility. And again, I want to talk specifically about those. Those don't mean that you have a bunch of empty rooms floating around in the buildings. It means that, again, when the state looks at your district against every other district that it's working with in the state of Ohio, that when you look at that and compare it against the design manual, that you have more square footage in areas than what they are typically providing from a co-funding standpoint. There are reprogramming dollars in each of the facilities. Reprogramming dollars are when we go into an area and we change its function, right? So if we go into a classroom area and we're going to change that from a kindergarten classroom to a sixth grade classroom, that is technically reprogramming. So there's reprogramming dollars that have been identified for each of the projects. And then you can also see there's specific allowances. And they're broken out by the buildings, so that's that swing space, the lead, and the storm shelter pieces. And so I have this obviously captured for each of the facilities, and I'm more than happy if you want to drill down in any of the details of those, we can do that. What I'd like to get to, though, is as we look at the cost summary, and you look at the individual costs for each of the facilities, and look at the project agreement LFIs, and then look at the overall state and local share, again, just a summary of that. So in looking at the building specific allowances, we've talked about this. This is the swing space, the lead, and the storm shelter. And you can see that right now it's totaling $5.6 million overall when we're in, we're looking at all the buildings together.
I'm sorry, I hate to interrupt you, but I'm trying to follow along. Do
sure.
Do we have this in our field report?
I think this is probably in addition to your executive summaries.
Okay,
so yeah. And again, we'll make sure the presentation is provided to everybody so you have details of it. So the building specific allowances, you can see the breakout of that for each of the facilities. Now, if you were to go in and renovate any of your facilities on your own, not working with the commission, some of these specific allowances probably wouldn't apply to you. You may or may not, for instance, go in and do anything in regards to swing space. You might not need to do swing space, or you might be able to accommodate that in another way, right? So this is, again, is the state applying their regulations on your project and specifically looking at it and again, trying to provide equity. Additionally, the lead allowance is starting to be folded into just the cost of regular construction, right? So when we talk about doing energy efficiency HVAC systems, for instance, we don't traditionally say, well, we're going to add 3% to make sure that we can cover that budget. We now have the ability, just because doing energy efficiency from an HVAC standpoint has been a focus now for a number of years. And so ultimately, you probably would effectively look at sort of adding specific allowances in order to make that happen. And then again, the swings, or the, excuse me, the storm shelter allowance, if you're going back in and renovating your existing facilities, you're not putting additions on the building, I don't think any of those are actually going to apply, just based on the interpretation of code. And so as we look at that, I think a lot of these allowances, again, if you're not working with the state, I think a lot of these allowances would go away if you were moving forward in a renovation project. The other piece, and the biggest piece, I think, are these project agreement LFIs. And again, I mentioned there are three categories. There's the non-OSDM, Ohio School Design Manual spaces. There's what would have been termed the oversized spaces and the excess square footage spaces. And if you look at the cumulative total of all of those, that's almost $6.5 million. And I think this is the biggest culprit of why working with the state in the CFAP process is probably not to Dexley's advantage. If you take a look at this, the OSDM non-recognized spaces are your auditoriums and your board offices. Okay, those are spaces that the state just doesn't co-fund. They made the determination back in 1997 when the state program was started that they were not going to co-fund auditoriums. And so any school district that moved forward in building a new auditorium did it at 100% local cost. Okay? And that's been equally applied since 1997. Additionally, the state has not funded board offices. Renovation of board offices or building new board offices. It's not something that they felt is a co-funded or needed to be a co-funded cost across the state. And so ultimately, those are two of the largest components of the project agreement out of bonds. The oversized square footage and the excess square footage, if we take a look at sort of a more detailed description of that, the oversized square footage really comes out of recognized program areas. So again, this is something that the OSDM includes. So for instance, corridors, gymnasiums, media centers, student dining spaces, and kitchen spaces. So if you think about this, these are the non-classroom spaces in a building, effectively. And what the state is doing is they're saying, if we were going to build a new 435 student elementary school, we believe that the gym should be this size, okay, based on that enrollment projection. And obviously, your elementary schools have roughly 7,000 square foot gymnasiums. That is significantly bigger than the 4,000 square foot gymnasium that would be provided in a new 435 student elementary. And so the state looks at that and says that gymnasium is oversized. Now, what they don't take into account is they obviously don't take into account the district athletic program. Right, what else is going on in the district that would require you to have a larger facility? Or your community needs, right? What is the community value? What did the community value when that gymnasium was built? And so ultimately, just because the state is applying this rule doesn't mean that there's anything wrong with the district having a larger gymnasium and being able to support those types of programs. And so again, this is just the state designating this based on the OSDM and what would be equal with other schools that are being built or renovated in the state.
So, in that, sorry, just a
certain
thing in my head.
Yeah.
So, in that example, if the, since it's recognized by the state, they would co-fund renovations to that space, but only up to 4,000 square feet.
That's
so, if
correct.
We renovate the whole thing, we would be responsible for the other 3,000 square feet.
That's exactly correct. Yep, right. And that's where the penalty comes from. The penalty is 100% of the rest of the square footage for that space. That's correct. And then, so obviously I said, not reflective of the building history. So another one of the things that that factors in is that, you know, some of your facilities haven't always been elementary schools, right? So if it was built as a facility to house K-8 or K-12 and it's now been converted to an elementary, well, some of the spaces are going to be larger than they need to be because it doubled the different student population throughout the system. That's not recognized in the state renovation project. So that's the oversized square footage piece. The excess square footage piece is really all the other areas of the building, so the classrooms are classroom areas of the building. Again, similar scenario that if you have more classroom square footage than what the OSDM would recommend for a 435 student elementary, then it ultimately comes back that you need to pay the 100% renovation cost of that excess square footage. Now, the example I like to use here is, let's say that your student-teacher ratio is really at 16 to 1 as opposed to 25 to 1, which is the state-mandated ratio that they use for planning. At 16 to 1, I need 3 classrooms to educate 48 students, right? Make sense? At 25 to 1, I need 2 classrooms to educate 50 students. If there's any additional square footage in that component, the state doesn't recognize it, right? They ultimately don't see that. They don't see that ratio or the relationship of that ratio as value. So ultimately, when they apply the rule, again, it comes back as a excess square footage cost in this relationship. So again, when we look at the relationships of what you would be paying in the project agreement LFIs, I'm jumping backwards. If we take a look, the project agreement LFIs are totaling $6.5 million. And the state share that we're going to receive is only $3 million. So, and to work with the state, you're going to pay them $3.5 million for the benefit of working with them. So, again, I I think that the alternative program might have some benefit to you, might have some value. So that may potentially be something that you want to consider, and we would be more than happy to work with you to understand how that starts to get applied with school districts as they start to use that program. As I mentioned before, right now, we really don't have any successful examples of school districts that have gone through that process, and we want to see how it's being applied and what the requirements are. The other next steps that we recommend, again, the OSFC, when they work on an assessment, they're focused on their design manual. They're focused on renovating to a like-new condition. And I know Eugene explained this to you a bit. But ultimately, if you have a roof and that roof is 17 years old and it's got a 20-year warranty, the state's going to look at that roof and say, you know, it's only got 3 years of life left. And so their recommendation is to pay to rip that roof off and then replace it and put it down with a new 20-year warranty roof. That ultimately makes good sense if we're trying to build to a like-new condition, but doesn't make great sense for a district that's thinking about maintenance dollars and how to proceed with your facility as you move forward. And so often what we find is that, again, the state assessment is good to a point, but ultimately in order to get a better understanding of what your forecast looks like, we really believe that a more detailed assessment is necessary. And so one of our recommendations is obviously you take the information that you receive from the state, but you also know that there is to do a deeper dive. And so that would be our recommendation moving forward is that if you want to create a forecast that really can be used for your strategic planning, you need to get more into the details to understand the systems. And so ultimately, I think that's my final recommendation tonight as far as what the next steps might look like.
In order to do that, is that something, is that a service that the state provides, or is that us going to hire an architect or a master planning firm to come and do that assessment?
It is not something the state would provide.
Okay.
Right? Their level of what they can provide you as far as details concerned ended with your own projections and the assessments that you received. So maybe we need to go up higher.
And all these numbers are all, like you said, all these facilities up to like, right?
That's correct, yep. Okay.
And then the other question I had, this is going back to the beginning, when we got to the wider field information, the district ranking, we're 558 out of 611. Is that fluid, or is that just, how is that, what is that number based on?
Sure. It's based on your district property valuation, your overall district property value, and your number of students, okay? And it does move. And so as your district is assessed, it works on a three-year average. And so ultimately, as things happen, you sort of go into the queue of that three-year average. And so what we see with a lot of districts is, for instance, we're working with a lot of rural districts that are starting to see, you know, pipelines coming into their district. And so that impact of that pipeline has sort of a cumulative effect. The first year, you know, the three-year average, it's offset by 2 years of lower property tax value. And then the next year, it becomes more, you know, more impactful. And then finally, the third year, and then you get up to full value. So those kinds of things start to, you know, they have sort of a weighted average as you move forward. I don't know if there's anything from a district standpoint that's going to make a significant change in the assessed value of the district at this point. I wouldn't expect that you're probably going to move more than a few percentage points over the next few years. It's a lot of information. Please, any other questions? Yeah.
Cost question.
Yeah.
Looking at the sort of detailed breakdowns of each of the buildings, it was very helpful. The costs kind of add up, and generally they're, you know, all the windows need to be replaced, but the HVAC needs to be redone, like they're very sort of succinct thing.
Right.
Where is the cost of the capture of the actual sort of space reconfiguration to change the building from, you know, housing 380 students to having 434 students? Obviously, I assume that would mean in classrooms and doing things that would have, you know, costs associated. I didn't see that. Well, that's anywhere, so I don't know if that's baked into it or it was additional cost or.
There is some money in there when you look at those reprogramming dollars.
Yeah.
So you see that line item. That is. That effectively is to do some reprogramming of spaces, so that would be tearing down some walls and reconfiguring some spaces. So you can see that some of the buildings, that number, you know, is almost $700,000 at the middle school and the high school, which actually seems kind of low to me ultimately. But at the elementaries, those numbers are actually pretty low.
Yeah,
like, so
asking them to, like, that's only $40,000
degree, like blue. Yeah, it's incredibly low. It's always been a struggle with the state to help them understand that even though we're taking an elementary school and we're going to keep keep it as an elementary school, that educational delivery has changed, right? And so we may very well look at doing some significant spatial changes, and that we may not just go back in with, you know, double-edged corridors, that we may try to open things up in order to create more flexible spaces and other types of educational delivery spaces. The state's being slow to realize that, and it's not folding into their program yet. And so we've had to fight with a lot of districts to go back in and say, hey, look, if we're really going to do something impactful here, not just come back with a double-edged corridor educational delivery model, we need more money there in that budget specifically.
So that was just my add as well, is that a $45 million budget captures sort of updating the facility to like new, you know, properties. But if you guys wanted to change instructional models or reconfigure large portions of the buildings for some other reason, that's probably gonna be cost added on to that level. So for planning purposes, we probably shouldn't assume that $45 million. If we wanted to do this as a whole one project, it would probably be $45 million, or something more than that, in order to accommodate the sort of additional layer of sort of learning improvements that we want to incorporate.
Okay.
I just want to make sure I was missing something.
No, not at all. What we do a lot with the school districts and working through master planning, you know, the state will tell you, hey, here's your master plan, but ultimately we find that that's not a full master plan picture, right? So we will work with school districts to identify local funded initiative dollars that ultimately will help, you know, improve the site, right, or a renovated project. Because you'll notice that if you look in the details, there's very little information or very little monies towards any of your sites, your school sites. They're just being inappropriate. That may or may not be true, and it ultimately doesn't help pick up things like, improving playgrounds that are maybe passive or useful today. So there's definitely some things like that on the educational side, definitely. Those reprogramming dollars are not out there to cover what potentially you may choose to do from the delivery standpoint. I would agree.
Because, Josh, they're basing that new building standard from a template from late 90s, is that right?
Eugene would tell you that the design manual is a living document and that it gets updated every 6 months, but I would agree that it's, especially in this reprogramming component, it's definitely going on. That's a fair point.
We'd be also taking out the, would you recommend and not proceeding with the state with these numbers, we would take out all the specific allowances also.
That's correct.
$3 million.
Yes, that's correct. I think that you may have some impact here. It's actually $5.6 million. You may have some impact here because you may have to do some swing space. In order to renovate an elementary school of the size of any of these buildings, it's going to take more than just a summer to do that type of work. And so there may very well be the need to swing the students out of those buildings. If you choose to build new, then it becomes a challenge of, are we going to build on the same site? Or are we going to take the building down and build new, or swing the students to another building to do that? I mean, there's definitely some challenges that will need to be addressed. So there will be some impact, but I definitely don't think it's going to be $5.6 million. Right.
In terms of the
Building
projections, you're recommending that we bring all of the elementary schools up to the same capacity. Is that supported by any kind of demographic study to say that all three neighborhoods that feed our elementary schools are growing at the same year, having a capacity over the next 10 years to grow at the same rate, so they would actually be equal, or would we actually want to? I don't know this, but the one or more of them actually, that neighborhood has more capacity to handle the additional influx of students who actually need to be made bigger, while the other ones may need to remain the same because those neighborhoods are at full capacity already in terms of how many students they can
take. It's a great question. What I can tell you is that the state is looking at you as a district. They're not looking at you as your tributary areas of the elementary.
So they just took the overall and divided by three.
That's
another, okay, so that would be another thing you have to look at in
right.
The future master plan.
That's a great question. Yeah. Because it may very well mean that, again, if you're keeping all three of the existing facilities, it may very well mean that one facility needs an addition or another facility needs a renovation and reprogramming of its space to fully suit. That's exactly right. Yeah. That's a really interesting question to think through.
So I would add from the purpose here, when we had not done an audit, so I think the state is a
facilities master plan.
A facilities master planner, we can do that. So as we decide that, and then as a community, what do we want? Then I think you're right, all those other pieces then have to come into play, and you have to do additional information. But it's nice, I think, to have good basic information about where things are and get a sense of what we have in place right now so that we can build for the future based on what we know, based on some knowledge. So. And the state does it for free, so take advantage of it.
Is that correct? Hopefully we're able to distill some of the information down for you. If anyone does have any questions, you can direct them to John and give them to me.
Okay.
Okay. Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you.
Appreciate it.
No, sir.
Sir.
Thank you very much.
Welcome.
That's right. At this point, we've moved to the public's comment section of our meeting. James, is anybody here?
Yes, we have two.
Yes, okay, thank you for anybody that hasn't signed in that's planning on giving public comments. If you could write your information on that sheet, so if you have any follow-up, you can do so. I forgot to mention that at the beginning of the meeting. So if you do have public comment, just a reminder, although under state law, the Board of Education is not required to offer public comment time during regular board meetings. We welcome the opportunity to hear from our community members. As such, we encourage your participation within certain parameters. Prior to the start of the meeting, we ask that you sign in on the public comment sheet at the podium. And when you come to the microphone, state your name and address. Please limit your comments to 5 minutes per board policy. Finally, we note that public comment is just that, the public's opportunity to be heard. It is not a Q&A session with the board. We look forward to hearing your comments, but per our board policy, we will not respond to public comment in the meeting or as individual board members. You can be assured that we're actively listening and taking notes for future reference. And as I mentioned, if you're on that sheet and there is follow-up that we needed, we'll have that information. So whoever would like to go first and public comment.
You can't pronounce that, it's me. My name is Alana Spector. If someone taking notes, that would be ILANASPECTOR. I live at 2444 Fair Avenue, and I have two children in the district. I have a third grader, and I have an eighth grader. And I'm here today to discuss an issue that impacts my third grader's ability to attend school here safely. My third grader, when he was about 2.5 years old, he went to a strawberry picking patch as a family. Had a cold, nothing unusual, until that evening when he started vomiting uncontrollably and making an odd noise when he was breathing, which prompted us to call our pediatrician's office. Our pediatrician told us to get him to an ER immediately, which we did. We were very glad. A normal oxygen level for an adult or any person is 97% or above. His was at 83%. He was admitted for 6 days to Children's in respiratory distress due to what was his first asthma. 3 months later, he had another severe asthma attack that again led to a hospitalization for 5 days, I believe. We started some asthma meds at that point in an attempt to control the attacks, but 3 weeks later, he had another severe attack. So we began looking for an underlying cause, and that underlying cause is environmental allergies. As his allergist put it this past January, he's allergic to outside and dogs. This past January, this district began allowing a student to bring a dog with her to school every day. Despite the fact that our medical records have been on file with the school since 2015, we were not notified that a dog would be brought to school, and no accommodations were offered. That means his ADA rights were violated. This is a big problem. So we had many conversations over the holiday break with Sam McMasters, and we were offered some accommodations that were better, but there were a lot of outstanding concerns. We were told repeatedly and in writing that this dog would not be coming to this building until those accommodations were in place. And yet one morning we got an email that the dog was here. So in January, we submitted an email to Superintendent Miller asking to clarify some answers for our concerns. We asked for a meeting, which was declined. Several weeks later, we got what I can only describe as a very generic response that did not address any of our concerns specifically. following in February, the 27th, you submitted more questions, which were similar in nature but more in detail. Questions like, what standard did this district use when determining if this animal is a service animal? It was first classified as a therapy animal, later now claimed to be a service animal. We have noted things that make us question that any standards were applied. I would presume it was written into an IEP or a 504, and I would like to know who reviewed this before that was done. We wanted to know if an animal is an emotional support animal, will the school district allow that animal? If the specific task or work that can be done by this animal can be done by an aide, will the school allow this animal? Who's responsible for supervising this? What is the procedure if somebody from the public shows up with a service animal? Is somebody supposed to confirm with them that it's a service animal? Is somebody supposed to note to the janitorial staff that this is where the animal went and needs to be cleaned appropriately? These are very valid concerns. We have been able to control my son's asthma through 4 daily asthma allergy medications, the same doses that anyone in this room would take. This is a 9-year-old kid, 4 medicines. And also by keeping him from being exposed to the allergens that trigger his asthma. We do not feel comfortable that the school has policies and procedures in place to address this. So that is what I'm here today to do, is to ask you as a board to specifically address our questions and concerns, which I can give you in hard copy or electronic, and also to create policies and procedures to answer these questions on a district-wide basis, so that I don't have to see somebody come in with an emotional support peacock and wonder if my kid is safe. Thank you. Are you allowed to ask questions of me? Or?
Thank you.
Thing that's being discussed a little bit later in the agenda. So I'm not going to do that because I don't know what's happening yet. But as kind of something that came out of my communication before during the discussion about the public safety forum kind of came up, and I wanted to bring it up kind of separately. Partially, this has to do with my being overly involved in the community. I kind of always want to be at all the meetings, right? So I've gone to a couple of the city council meetings, and sometimes I can't go just because of childcare arrangements or just having a busy life. And the city council has the live stream feed of their monthly meeting, or I guess bi-monthly meeting. To my knowledge, we do not have that for this meeting. Question. I don't think we do. So it's a little bit harder for me to come to these meetings, specifically given my kind of personal situation. And in some of the email that I read, there was an indication that something had been discussed at the March meeting. So I thought, well, I'll just go and look at the video, I believe, because they are videotaped. And see what was said at that meeting in March. The place that I expected to find it was on the website, under the Board of Education, under Meeting Archives, which I think is where I went. And when I went there, the only meeting video archive that was there was November 2017, which is several months ago. Now, March wasn't that long ago. Technology is weird. I didn't necessarily expect there to be a March meeting there. I hope there was. Didn't expect it. I sort of did expect December, January, February to be there. This is particularly bothersome to me just because I am one of those people that does want to keep up what's happening. And like I said, it's a little tricky for me to come here every month. I know that there are other people that have expressed frustration about their inability to either come to a live meeting or see a live feed lot of communication occurring about what's happening in these meetings. And I, for one, would like to have that information, especially what's happening tonight about the discussion with the safety board. I know of 8 people that wanted to come tonight that couldn't, and they definitely couldn't stay until 10 or whatever. So I'm encouraging you all, since you're looking at this communication-related things, to look at what we might be able to do better in terms of like a live feed with Granicus. I don't own Granicus. I don't know anything about Granicus except what it is, because I think that would be really helpful for community members who can't always be here to be more involved, because I think that's really what we all want.
Agenda item 7A, or I'm sorry, 8A through H, which is our business consent agenda. I know that we've had a lot of discussion with a lot of these things already in our executive report, which is always very helpful to answer questions. So I guess I would ask for a motion to approve.
Mr. Burns, I'd like to add that I don't believe I see the Maryland Playground as an option for approval. Correct. This would be the appropriate section to add that. It's in the executive reports, but as far as an action item, it's
not. Oh, okay. Thanks for pointing that out. I believe that would be a business consent agenda, correct? So let's just do with what we have here,
right,
and then
we can
add it on.
Yep.
I believe we have to do by motion. So again, on 8A through H, Any discussion on items 8A through H? If there's any additional comments?
I can update everyone that sent the line text about the BSN contract, but approving it will not create a problem for us on the logo.
Okay.
So,
great.
The date of the contract. So do I have a motion to add on as item a consent agenda item 8I, I guess it would be, which would be the approval of the Maryland Playground. Do I have a motion?
It's not a consent agenda.
Okay.
I would just make
no, you
so I move to approve the
this motion takes care of that. It looks everything out there. This is not a new case yet.
Okay. So I understand Ms. Snowden has moved to approve the Maryland project overview for the Maryland Playground, which includes the design. It says project overview, project course of action, and the cost, as well as approving a PO for us to include the PO as presented in the document that was provided earlier.
In addition to that, one more thing is they mentioned funds, but they did not have all the funds. Are you comfortable with the timing of funds coming to the district? So I could issue a PO this week. Would have, I think she said, $54,000 of that now, and then the district kind of, I guess, loaning this project that money to the rest of them. I think that should also be a part of this resolution.
Yeah, the
you're okay with that.
We're willing to approve it as it's written with as their
with the shortfall
as they communicated.
And that's without their media.
I guess if since they knew the PTO has the funding, then I wouldn't put us in a position that would fund the communication from time we have to work out the PTO, that's a resource of the PTO, so the district should have to have the money there.
Is this approving the purchase order, right, as opposed to the actual funds, right? I mean you're not writing a check mark.
No.
So we're approving the purchase order for the entire amount of $62,150, understanding that right now they have $52,250.
Yeah, I believe she said $28,000 of it is needed up front, so that that cash is will be on hand.
The commission's desire to be placed to order.
Yeah, right. And so the final payment probably won't be until July or August, pretty much. So this is probably very useful.
So, I don't want to use the record here. Yeah, so one of them is wrong.
Okay.
Before we motion to approve the project overview from the Maryland Playground, including the course of action and costs, and to furthermore, authorize the use of purchase order.
Authorize the district to issue a purchase order.
Thank you. Authorize the district to issue a purchase order for the full amount of this $62,150.
Great.
So moved. You're seconding my.
All right. Any further discussion?
One more discussion. And it is whether we need to insert a phrase into what Marley's motion is, or just ask to past practice. Now, we in the past approved plans before they were approved by the city.
Yes.
Yeah.
So
and it's always a chicken and egg, right?
Yeah.
And here's why. If I go to the city first and they say yes, and then I come to you and you say no, so you're the highest body, so you say yes, then I go to the city. I don't go to the city first.
So we have to give them the finalized plan before they have to approve it, rather than
but yes, they will ask me, are you good with this?
Okay.
As long as we're following past precedent.
Yes.
And this is kosher.
And so Montrose was 100% in, and then Cassingham was 90% in. So it's very low. I always come to you first, then to the city. Because if I get it the other way, then that's a bigger problem.
If the city necessitates changes, they won't come back to us.
To you, yeah. I'll bring it back to you.
That's a good question. Any other discussion? All those in favor of Mrs. Snowden's motion, and I will not repeat. That's so eloquently stated. Those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? Moving on to resolutions, which is agenda item 10A, B, C, and D, 10A through D. Do I have a motion to approve resolutions 10A through D? What we've been doing, trying to do is approve the, or ask for a motion to approve the second, and then you can discuss any of these, and then if we decide that we don't want to approve something, we can do that.
So.
So, any discussion on 10A through D?
Yeah. Before we get to the added question about
this that paragraph seems very permissive, that like it's something you can do and it's just part of the policy. I think our past experience has been that we want teachers or administrators who are putting forth field trips to plan far in advance that they get on the schedule. Yes, emergency, yeah, something like that. They just said, you know, obviously we want to be accommodating, but we're not going to do this. So,
so you're talking about adding language to, maybe I was the follow-up that you're saying. So
given that we value to get that information and it's on here, would it be better to just not vote on this right now, take it off, let the policy committee go back into it and correct it so that we're not writing in the role here is to approve it or not approve it? Could you pull it off and let the policy committee go back into it and get any information to us prior to the next policy committee meeting? That way we can just work on it.
I want to discuss 10B.
understand we don't always have options. I just wanted to register with it. I hope that, you know, and I know that when the situation arises, again, we always try to give as much time as possible. It's just that in this circumstance, we can't. And I guess that's, I want to communicate that's the reason why I understand that's why.
And to the there are some districts that have two school board meetings per month, too. So these kinds of things, because we meet monthly, and because of the timing, and I know this because my oldest daughter is applying for numerous jobs and has been combing all the websites for
yeah.
teaching job, that this is the time is of the essence, and why I believe, I don't mean to speak for superintendent, but why she reached out to each of us, because we can't discuss it among ourselves until we're at the public meeting. Why we're having this discussion right now, I definitely appreciate that, and especially when we're talking about a position like this. And so to kind of your concern is completely valid. One of the things that I look at when we have these things come up is that there are going to be things that you can't plan for when you have one school board meeting per month, and this is this director of staff and student operations is a position that I think is greatly needed, and time is of the essence to get it. This agenda, albeit late, and it is here, and we're discussing it at the public meeting. So, those are my thoughts, and I'm not discounting your concern.
Yeah, no, I appreciate it so much.
But it is, I think that's part of the reason why I see why it's on there. And again,
I don't disagree, and it is, as again, as over the course of the year being asked, what do you need? And to the point now of getting, you know, started strategic planning, I've had this list. If we're approving, I'm asking you to approve a job description, not a person at this point, but if we were discussed more and wanted to really pursue this without job waiting a month to do a job description, and I would never want to come to you with a recommendation for an employee when we haven't approved a job description. So we have other job descriptions and we haven't filled those positions, but having it gives us some flexibility, and again, you know, in year two, I'll have a better sense of where we are as I go through this year, but as we're looking, so, you know, in fact, again, up until this month, we've had our board agendas approved three, you know, on Wednesdays before, which is much better, but things sometimes happen, as you said, one board meeting a month makes it, if you wait from April to May,
I would say the typical way that we would do this after events, like a multi-month process, it's not so much the timing of it, although I agree with everything Marley said in terms of that I support your assessment of the situation and your desire to do something to address it. One question I had would be to what is the salary level for this?
So we have salary ranges, and as I explained individually, I see this as a level 4 on our salary ranges, but it's not on there because we don't have this job description.
But I thought the salary ranges applied to positions, not people. So,
there's a position.
So
this
was
a position. The position which I would recommend.
Which the range is
100-125,000.
And I guess just to be clear, we're talking about this in terms of the urgency of it. So I just want to be clear amongst ourselves and also to the public that if we approve this, your desire is to go to move forward posting. It's not a hypothetical. This is something you can call on in the future. Something we will post. So we don't have someone to recommend for the position right now, but we will move forward.
I want to talk about, obviously I'm bringing it up and I'm talking about because yes, I feel that that's something I want to talk with you more about, but again, I'm sure, even though the timing, again, would be nice if things were sooner, but I want, without it, there's nothing to discuss.
But
to discuss that.
Okay.
Does that make sense?
Well, I mean, I think the reason we need to vote on it so quickly after seeing it, for the first time tonight and hearing about it this weekend is because there's an urgency to get this
those in favor of approving resolutions A, C, and D, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Those opposed? Thank you. So that is, and so B will be sent back to the policy committee for the language that Mr. Dennis, if you could just send it to, it's the policy committee here. Send it to him.
Do you have to me or?
Whoever would like to take the floor. I don't want to talk too long on it. Maybe limit this. We're not here all night, but maybe about 10 minutes or so. And if you need to go a little bit further, that's fine. But I want to make sure we're not going too much beyond that 10 minutes or so. Anybody who would like to discuss this or have thoughts about the 4 months?
Be more succinct than out of my previous statement. Okay, so here are my thoughts on this. Just to get the conversation started, because I do think we should, I am glad to have a discussion topic. And I think when I, we certainly all received letters from community members asking about this, and I think we've all been informed the issue, just top of the newspaper. But as far as I look at it, to me, you have to ask, what would a purpose be for school safety? And I don't know if you all had a chance to look at, I sent you a draft agenda on what, and actually Tony Lampy has sent it to me, and I changed it just slightly before sending it on to you all about what it would look like, because I wouldn't want to have a forum without a purpose. I don't want it to be just like an open mic, and that seems like a waste of our resources and time of our administration. So I want to be really mindful of the time that our administration puts into this. Issue certainly. So I think the purpose would be, and by my way of thinking, would be to educate and inform our community about what we're doing in school safety for school safety already. Superintendent Miller and I have had an opportunity to discuss this a bit, and when I try to look at it as if I'm a community member and I want to know what we're doing with school safety. So I got on our website, and there just wasn't a lot there. And there was a note from Ms. Miller on February 14th that discussed the topic. But it's a difficult subject because you can't be, as Mr. Eikenberry keeps saying, you can't be super specific. But I feel like we could be more specific. We could give some other information about what happens in our overall process. I mean, we can say, well, we have a process, but I think we ought to be forthcoming about what things are coming out of the process. The original review that Mr. Eikenberry and Mr. Ellis and Mr. Hood did, and then this July meeting that's coming about, or July deadline, for more information, I think we should be communicating those things. And it may be that this is the best way to do that. I mean, I think it's certainly an option.
thought it would foster a positive school environment by allowing parents to ask questions, be listened to, and create trust. And I think that that's a very worthy reason as well. So those are kind of my thoughts on why we might do it, what it would look like. I think this is what I've, the agenda that I passed out is kind of what I would think of. The possibility of what we might ask, we would talk about, and then, you know, I don't really have my ideas for us timing of when we might do this, except for that I think it might make more sense to do it after the July 1st report is given, so that we really have concrete information to give to our community. And I think Ms. Miller should be a presenter with the mayor and police chief, because one of the many reasons we hired her, she's really good at things like that. So I'd like to have her out in front of our public and maybe if we answer those questions. So those are my thoughts.
I agree that it's, if we do have, we are looking at doing this, to many factors that we have the next agenda.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it should be after we have a review, because our procedures could change.
Yeah.
What we do, the outcomes could change, who does what could change.
Mm-hmm.
And we don't want to get misinformation today and have to go back and change it.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't see any real value in doing it right now, given that we are under review and we have a committee that is dedicating themselves to examining what we do and make recommendations. And so once that is done, if the community understands that we're taking this vital step, using professionals to revise what we do, we have a plan to drill as long as, you know, those are the kinds of things I think the community knew, those kinds of things that would make me feel better about what we do. But that hasn't happened after the next 2 years, because it's otherwise it's a repeat.
My only question about that, and I don't know, and this is I guess a question for John, is are there anything about the topics that we would discuss at the meeting that could somehow inform your task force? And like whether there was a resource officer, or whether there was some thought about how the community has, you know, maybe the values have changed around how we access the school buildings or open lunch or things like that, that would actually be an opportunity to gather input that then would give you additional information as you're going through the process with the task force versus going through a process and having a conversation with the community and saying, actually, we really want a resource officer. We really want to revise how access is given to the buildings and then have to go through and update them again. I don't know if that's true or not, but that would be my question. Go.
Can I throw something else in before you answer, John? Which would be, is there a benefit to having meeting or having a forum and having the task force there to hear the feedback at first hand? I mean, that kind of thinking back to what that's the question.
So twofold. For safety drills, which is what was in your emergency operations plan. So it'll say in the event of lockdown, you do this, current one, put that paradox to that. Then there's school security measures. And so the latter is where you would discuss changes in the community thought pattern, SRO, no open lunch, this, that, the other. So this committee, this task force rather, is their bailiwick, this is their specialty of the steps you follow to ensure safety as best you can. The forum, if I'm hearing right, is more towards the latter of possible changes to improve, I'll use the word security, I know it's tied to the safety, two less words, but that's a latter discussion. So again, it would be what's the agenda, and then, but certainly the discussion about do we want an SRO, do we want, right now, the door's unlocked so the students can come in. Do we want that protocol, that regulation, or whatever you want to call it, to change? That would be discussion items to get input from the community on those type of things. And that dovetails with
strat planning, that facilities committee, council, whatever terminology you want, security is part of that. And those things can deliberate in that form if that's where you want to do that. But this because it's private information that typically you hire your specialist to help you with, that's your safety drills. That's why I call it a task force for safety action steps. It is the quick twist locks. It is the, you know, what to do, scan the hallway, step to ensure safety.
So I think what, to paraphrase what I think you're saying is that although that discussion to those kind of more values-based things would be useful, it actually doesn't impact the work of the task force precisely because the task force is doing something more limited in scope in terms of like,
there,
what is the process? If something happens, this is what we do. We're not sort of...
What does Sergeant Overly say? Boom, 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 boom.
Yeah. So there's someone separated.
This one is the, if you will, security measures and what we want to increase as, okay, community, what's your thoughts on this, whatever those specific agenda items are, whether that's SRO, whether that's closed lunch, whether that's all doors are locked, everybody comes with a fob, that's security measures.
I would propose that want to explore, it becomes, like you said, a value. How much do you want to keep because it's Bexley and we like this, and how much more safety do you want? So where do you want to be? Do we want only one door open in this entire complex every morning when students come in so they have to funnel from the same place? So students open doors for other people all the time, reminding you that some of these situations have happened in school. Either had a legitimate reason to be in that building, so this doesn't.
Sure. I mean,
or they get someone to let them in. So.
Or they know the protocol.
Or they know the protocol. So I my suggestion is simply if you want to go through a bigger review of do we want to investigate a school resource officer? Do we want to look at some of our procedures and how where are parents and how where do we want to live? I would recommend that become an annual objective for us to tackle that because it's not as simple as a meeting because you will not get that's a more you're going to need more broad-based input than you would have at a meeting. In addition, part of strategic planning will have a component of safe schools, and now safe isn't just safe in terms of locks, it's safe in terms of emotional safety and all of those pieces. So that would be part of strategic planning, and that's where making this more of an objective to tackle probably almost has
and to kind of piggyback on what you're saying, I think what Ms. Snowden said about having specific goals and a specific purpose and making sure that we're doing something like this where we're utilizing the resources of our administration as well as the city that we're not inefficient with those and having a perfect purpose and being specific about what this meeting would entail, which would maybe include discussion of the community about SRO. One other thing, as I mentioned earlier, we're meeting with the city tomorrow. This is something that we're going to talk about how this would be coordinated because it's not just saying, hey, let's put this together and we're doing it because obviously the police are involved. So this is a discussion which is pretty timely to have with the city tomorrow in our quarterly leadership meeting. Also, I think with the three-year review, when we talk about the three-year review, is if we have these standards and these procedures in place, then if the committee, the security specialist says, as Ms. Miller pointed out, we can't have Cassie Camp door open or after open lunch that the back door over by the back door over by the field can't be open at all because kids come in there in the morning, during after open lunch. So when they look at these things, these are their recommendations, which are obvious once they get put into place. They're not secret. They're like, okay, you can't use that door anymore. Then we go to the community and say, here's what the 3-year review on our safety have decided. What is your value? Where do you want to place that? Do we want to keep open more? Which I know we had a survey on that. Where do we want to fall with that? And then with the strategic planning, I know that that's part of that with a lot of community input. Getting that input too, which is more broad-based. And then the timing to do it. I mean, I know just Ms. Miller and us were in the middle of negotiations, starting up the strategic plan. I mean, I was just pulled out, printed off the strategic planning proposed timeline. And it's, I mean, it's packed full of stuff. And I think the suggestion made by Ms. Miller about maybe making this one of her objectives for next year and moving forward and not rushing to, hey, let's just have a meeting. Let's have a specific purpose, not be inefficient. Let's get all the information that we need to before we move to the forum on safety and have a good idea of where we want to go and what we can offer to the community in the discussion on this agenda. Here's what we've done. Here's what we're doing. Where do we think that the community wants to do, like open lunch or something like that? And I think it's important to be specific and goal-driven, as Ms. Snowden started off with, to, when we do something like a community forum, especially when coordinating all the resources.
Well, I think if we do get recommendations from professionals, they could very well point out the weak spots that we have. Maybe it's not lunch. You know, how do we know that?
Right.
And so until it's examined by a professional, they do a review, and you know, maybe it is the front door access that is our weakest spot. You know, that you, I mean, I go to Maryland Avenue, I just get buzzed in. And you know, I just walk into the building. Once I access that building, I have access, I could plow down people no matter what. But I've been admitted to the building. There are other weak spots, but you're right. The values that we have, no, we want to protect our children at the entry. No one else is allowed in buildings. I mean, that may be what they say. So we need to ask the committee, I mean, the community, what their value system is based on our weak spots, not just a general discussion about lunch, because lunch may not be the weak spot. So I think that we have to get the professionals, examine what we have, recommend changes.
I understand, like, are they doing assessment of our weak spots, or are they just creating a protocol for what happens when we have an event? Because those are two different things.
So think of it, safety drills, the task force is on safety drills. And then risk mitigation. So risk mitigation should be part of that strategic plan.
So that's not part of the task force.
It is not. This is how do you march when someone called lockdown? How do you march in snowfield? Step. So your military, your police, your fire, your safety professionals, that's their speed. That's how they talk.
So what
risk mitigation would be,
what Melissa's talking about is not part of that task force.
It is right.
Oh, they're not going to do that.
They're not going
to examine our entry.
This is safety steps for threats. Whether that's smoke of gas, tornado, this is safety plans. This is how you drill. This is what you drill.
Safety plans that are required by law to be, that's the 3-year review. The other piece, and I like your term, get values. And a component of that through strategic planning, I talked earlier about, once you have a strategic plan, there'll be a facilities component we've already discussed. Some of those safety features, security features,
risk mitigation
becomes part of that group. And then that's the value piece of, okay, do you want to lock more doors or do you want more access? And you have to decide where your value is. That's going to take more time to get done. They have a short timeline because what you do in a fire drill, that's probably not going to change drastically from what we already have. There are two different things. One, the task, that's why we call it a task force. They have a task, they get it done. I still think what they have can inform communication, but then the other bigger piece of how much risk do we want to mitigate? And how much openness do we want to have as a community? You decide.
is you've now tapped into those resources, so that next phase, I can plug them in as you wish, because you identify great resources. But you're right, completely correct. In that regard.
I mean, I want it. I mean, it sounds like we're moving towards pushing this out. I think the only thing I would say to what was done about earlier is that, you know, I don't think there's ever anything wrong or inefficient, to use the term that we spent, about listening to the concerns and questions about our community members around what is arguably our number one responsibility, which is providing safety for their students. And so I, regardless of whether this becomes a longer process, which I fully support, you know, trying to think about it more comprehensively and making sure that we're not just doing, the worst thing we can do is have a meeting and then say, oh, we checked the box, done, now we don't have to, you know, like, we don't want to do that. Like, I completely agree with that. I don't think making it part of a longer process means that we can't have a meeting to discuss, even if it's not presenting a final solution, just to say, like, hey, let's have a discussion, let's let people know where we're at. You know, we've talked about a few different things tonight that touch on school safety that I think the broader community doesn't know or isn't aware of, but I think they would be hopefully reassured or pleasantly surprised to know that we're doing that work. And then to just have a discussion, like, I don't think it's inefficient to have open mic is maybe not the word I would use, but have an opportunity for people to ask the questions around these issues, because they are really important and they do touch on very kind of emotional, important things to them. And if you don't have an answer, it's fine. You say, you know, that's part of what we're looking at strategic planning, or that's what we're going to look at as part of this future goal. But we might have an answer for some of it, and I think that would be, that again goes to the notion of, like, building trust and being open and having communication. And I don't think everything has to be part of something that let's just talk about it in 6 months or a year. I think we can start the conversation now, since there are lots of discussions happening in our broader culture around these issues, and they have, you know, obviously school safety is important all the time, but it's gotten a little bit of a push now because of unfortunate circumstances. And I personally don't think that, I think having a meeting, whether it's now or in July, doesn't preempt to any of the things we're talking about. I think it would actually be well received in terms of being, you know, having that at the start of that conversation.
Right. So that's kind of piggybacking on that, informing the community. I know there's been a lot of meetings in PTO and information pushed out, and I think that that's, parents have got emails from the building principals about a lot of this stuff. So going back to what Ms. Snowden started off here, I don't think much more out of it. Now, is being specific about what this forum would be about, and that would be talking, informing the community on what we've done, again, not specifically, but what we do as a school, not just every 3 years, whatever, but every day, every year, every month, whatever it may be, and how we handle things. And I think having that specific purpose and that specific goal is always important to making sure that we're informing the community, not getting lost in a lot of other things.
If I may
we are open to it, it sounds like, to at least have a discussion to see what they think it would look like. And then I can report back, and then we're not voting on anything tonight, but to get the feedback in open session so the public can hear it, and so not violating sunshine laws either, so we all have a good idea of where, what our purposes would be if we just decide to put a resolution on the agenda of, okay, we're going to have a school safety forum, this is what we're going to do, and that would be a specific resolution, I believe, I'm not sure, to vote on and have direction to the administration, whoever, to put this in place or however we want to do it. As we discuss it tonight, if you don't want to wrap it up, we'll wait longer than
so, yeah.
10 minutes, but I don't like this.
Okay, so in response like to this entire discussion, I guess the question I have is, if we have a community forum, is the objective to hear, to communicate out, or to have both? You know what I mean? And I feel like that's where we're kind of at, is like we're talking about wanting to put our message out. Is it also equally as important to hear the message in? I mean, that's the crux of like whether or not what the agenda would look like. How
was
the direction of
the
communication?
Well, and to kind of respond to that, I think there were 18 emails that I got about this.
Right.
It seemed to me that the general overarching concern was to put out information, to tell people what we're doing, and not getting specific, but what we're doing to address certain issues. Now, there are certain issues that we have no control over, but there are generally, to answer your question, is to put information out. One other item that's not on the agenda, and I don't think we can discuss this other than open meeting. We tried to have a couple of work sessions. We talked about it. April 5th, that one was canceled, I know now. April 24th, two of our members can't make it. So, Mr. Dennison and Ms. LaPlaca, I know it's so. No, but then
I don't think I should keep the last one because I'm just going to keep adding.
So here's what, if you guys can individually let me know a couple of dates that you have available, because then we have to get Bill Reimer to make sure he's on board. So if you could give me two dates that I know nobody can be for sure, but if you could give me two dates sooner rather than later, that we could do this work session, because I know we try to schedule it. Let's just try one more time to get it to where we can get all of us there if possible.
So sometime after April 24th,
it doesn't have to be after the 24th. It's just I'll have to get with Ms. Miller and Ms. Reimer.
Can you have
maybe
some of
Yeah, okay, that's great. Yeah. Let's see, call the Google.
The doodle, she said that the last time.
The other option is just to do this all on a regular meeting. It's long, another long regular meeting.
It's easier to do on a Saturday. You said that you allow with some options that have weekends, maybe we can then find a good one.
If we consider a Saturday, like after 10 o'clock in the morning, would be preferable for me, because I do work on weekends.
Yeah.
So, I mean, it's eliminating the whole Saturday, just so I'm starting on.
Yes. Okay. Well, I'll make this promise.
That's right.
We sometimes do have some weekdays and some weekends. If we end up choosing a weekday, I'll just take the day off work.
Okay.
So, with that said, are there any other matters that may properly come before the board? Hearing none, we are now going into executive session, and I want to make sure comply with the laws of Ohio. Whereas a public board of education may hold an executive session only after a majority of the quorum of the board determines by a roll call vote to hold such a session only at a regular or special meeting for the sole purpose of the consideration of any of the following matters. A, to consider one or more as applicable, which would be A2, A1 appointment, A2 employment,
Mr. Stover?
Yes.
Mr. Kwok?
Yes.
Mr. Dennison?